Ladies and gentlemen, get your attention, please. We're going to begin the forum. Thank you all very much for joining us. My name is Mac Carey. I'm CEO of the Lexington Institute. We appreciate everybody taking time out of their schedules today, and especially we've got a terrific roster of speakers, and we appreciate them being so willing to help us out. This is part of our series of forums on Capitol Hill on defense acquisition reform. It's become a very important and focused and intense effort in recent months, thanks to the NDAA and some of the other developments out there. So we're glad to, again, have such a great group of speakers and such a good audience. If you don't mind, please turn your cell phones on to silence for the remainder of the forum. And also, we've got a pretty big group today. We want everybody to be able to hear the speakers, so please keep your side conversations to a minimum. That would be most helpful. We are going to do a series of back-to-back 10-minute speeches from our subject matter experts. Our goal is to get you a lot of very good information quickly on this subject. I think you'll like the forum if you haven't been to one of ours before. And we're just going to go boom, boom, boom right through the speeches with a lot of great information. Our first speaker today is Phil Jasper, Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer for Rockwell Collins. He's also an executive officer of the company. He has a multi-decade experience in bomber, helicopter, and other important aviation programs. And we're glad to have you here, and look forward to your remarks.
Thanks, Mac, for the introduction. Although the multi-decade part, I'm not sure, makes me feel a little bit old. So, again, thanks also for the privilege of being a part of this event. I'm here because I believe defense acquisition reform is ultimately all about working together to help the warfighter and to keep our country safe. And while we may have differing viewpoints on how to improve the system, I think we can all agree that when people's lives are on the line, they should have access to cutting-edge, affordable, effective technology. For decades, we've been working together to improve defense acquisition. Now, some of you may say that we've seen little success, but I'd like to think that we've been moving in the right direction. However, I am concerned that we're starting to move backward. To explain why, I'd like to share with you a case study about our company. If you worked with my company a few decades ago, you quickly learned that Rockwell Collins was split into two completely separate, different businesses, largely due to the imposition of government-unique terms and conditions, audits, cost accounting, and other costly tracking and reporting requirements. One business served the government customers, and the other business served the commercial customers. This separation included duplicating all functions and establishing separate production, research and development, engineering, and administrative functions. The reality was the cost of compliance with government unique terms was such a burden that it couldn't be supported in the commercial marketplace. The result was that our company wasn't efficient, our military products were unique and expensive, and our DoD customers were not getting the latest, most innovative commercial technology they needed to be successful. But in the 1990s, that all changed due to the enactment of the Federal Acquisition Streamlining Act, the Federal Acquisition Reform Act, and other initiatives. Through these reforms, the federal government reached out to the commercial industry and was able to reduce the barriers to enable them to provide their innovative and cutting-edge products and technologies. From our perspective, the reforms enabled Rockwell Collins to leverage our commercial innovations and eliminate overhead redundancies, which in turn reduced costs. Under the newly created FAR Part 12, we were allowed to bring forward the innovative technology in which our commercial businesses invested heavily. We were also able to streamline our operations so that our corporate and shareowner goals could be achieved while satisfying our DoD's customers' needs for affordable and effective technology. The advantages have been profound for our government customers. For example, using commercially available technology, our precision lightweight GPS receiver or plugger saved the DoD over $300 million. Over the past decade, Rockwell Collins has invested $200 million to build and support 17 GPS product lines. These receivers are all of a type available in the commercial marketplace and yet still meet the government's security and unique military environmental requirements. The use of commercial-based technologies on the KC-135 Global Air Traffic Management Upgrade Program enabled the Air Force to leverage hundreds of millions of dollars of company-funded commercial investment and resulted in completing the upgrade in less than half the time of previous programs. We saved the DoD more than $160 million in development costs for the Common Avionics Architecture System, an open architecture avionics system that was incorporated into the Black Hawk and Chinook helicopter fleets. And the displays on the KC-46 tanker are state-of-the-art because they were first developed commercially for the Boeing 787 and then modified for military use. Secretary Carter has made it clear that the gap between the defense and commercial marketplace must be bridged. As you can see from the examples I just mentioned, we understand both worlds and are in a great position to provide more innovative commercial technology to the warfighter. And this is why we've been a longtime advocate of commercial FAR Part 12 contracting. We have seen and have experienced the mutual benefits. Our military customers save on expenses for development. They don't have to worry about managing obsolescence costs, and they have access to the latest commercially developed technologies in a more timely manner. Our company can leverage our commercial investments and innovations and eliminate redundancies. But the problem for commercial companies like Rockwell Collins is that acquisition processes and regulations are ever-changing and are often in direct conflict with providing commercial technology to the government. Despite the rhetoric of breaking down barriers to commercial companies, it feels like the acquisition system is resisting allowing companies such as ours to provide modified commercial technology to the Department of Defense. For example, a decade ago, we received a commercial item determination for our commercial displays with slight modifications to be used on a military helicopter program. That is precisely what FAR Part 12 envisioned, to facilitate DoD's access to innovative commercial technology that could be slightly modified to enable the warfighter to use it. In the case of our displays, that meant doing things like ruggedizing the box or adding filters to enable the use of the commercial display with military night vision systems. In the acquisition world, these are referred to as commercial items of a type. They're not exactly the same as the commercial product, but they're pretty close. Now, even though we have been providing those displays for more than 10 years as a commercial item, last year, the government challenged that determination. It took 9 months to successfully resolve that challenge to reaffirm that they are indeed commercial items. But there's more. Just earlier this month, the government has again challenged the commercial position of those displays. Here we go again. This is not a good formula for the long-term success for either party, and it's certainly not a formula to entice commercial companies to want to do more business with the DoD. And ultimately, it's not good for our warfighters because it delays our ability to deliver the technology they need in a timely manner. While I'm encouraged by the direction of Secretary Carter and the legislative improvements in the FY16 NDAA, there are roadblocks that still exist and are preventing greater success in providing commercial technology. Now is the time to take steps to remove those roadblocks. And I see 4 steps that should be taken immediately. First, regulations and interpretations around what products and services are commercial items are getting more restrictive, not less, and that needs to change immediately. The commercial item procurement reforms in the recently passed National Defense Authorization Act are a good start. That act clearly recognizes the value of commercial of a type products and the fact that prior commercial item determinations should be allowed to be carried forward. Second, to ensure consistent alignment with rule interpretation and leadership expectations, the DoD and the Defense Acquisition University must train contracting officers on what commercial items are, how commercial business cases are established, and how to acquire and value commercial items. In the example I highlighted previously, well-meaning individuals are focused on comparing sales of the exact same item in the commercial market. But by definition, there often aren't sales of the same item because it's been slightly modified for military use. Rather, the proper comparison is with the price of similar items in the marketplace. Understanding and appreciating that distinction, which the law recognizes and provides for, is important and simply a matter of effective training. It is not enough to rely on centers of excellence. We must train the acquisition workforce. Third, we need greater dialogue between industry and the government around intellectual property protection. In many cases, the current approach creates big barriers when we invest, take all the risk, and then have to give our IP away to our competitors. This is an area the Defense Business Board has identified as needing improvement, and I hope industry and the DoD can focus on IP protection in collaboration with one another over the next year. And finally, the broader discussion needs to shift towards the value of commercial item procurements and away from restricting the profit level contractors make. Look, the industry wants to ensure the taxpayer is getting value for their dollar as much as the government does. At the same time, commercial businesses invest huge sums of money over long periods of time in the name of technological innovation. They, along with their shareholders, expect to receive a reasonable return on that investment. Focusing on profit level instead of value and price ignores the substantial investments that have been made, as well as the other tangible benefits of commercial procurement, such as the costs and risks of obsolescence, which are expenses borne by the contractor and not the taxpayer. Focusing on profit level also ignores the fact that the vast majority of commercial items are fixed price arrangements. Commercial companies are generally not in the cost plus business, where taxpayers bear the risks of overruns. Under fixed price contracts, the commercial company bears the risks. It is in their best interest to control costs, become more efficient, and deliver on time. Those are the four areas that I believe we should work on in the coming year. Now, while there are areas that I just highlighted where we need continued improvement, we have made great progress since the passage of the FASA in 1994. But by continuing to eliminate the barriers that stand in our way, we can better access commercial technologies and provide our warfighters the capability they need to keep our nation safe. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Phil. Our next speaker is former Senator Jim Talent from Missouri. He is a senior fellow at the American Enterprise Institute now. While he was in the Senate, he was a member of the Senate Armed Services Committee and the chairman of the Sea Power Subcommittee of that panel. He's also been a key advisor to Governor Romney on his two presidential campaigns. Welcome, sir. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Mac. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. And thanks to everybody here who works in this field, which I assume is just about everybody here. You know, these are difficult times for the United States, and I think there are more difficult times coming up. But one of our great strengths is America's innovative and productive capability, which has expressed itself through partnerships between the federal government and the defense industrial base, and you're the people who make that partnership go, and I appreciate that. And the chance to talk about acquisition and learn about acquisition from others here today. This is one of these subjects where the challenge is to say something without trying to say everything in 10 minutes. So I'm going to kind of take an overview about where I see the problem is and why I believe the latest steps that the Congress is taking, that many of you all are taking, are good steps, and are the beginning of the path out. So when you focus on the problem, I'm going to focus on the external source of the problem and then the internal one. Most people don't focus on the external, so I do try and talk about the external problem and the reason for many of our acquisition issues is 20 years of inadequate and unstable funding for procurement and modernization. It's gotten a lot worse under the sequester, but it goes back to the 90s. I remember it vividly because I was a kid congressman at the time, and those were the days when appropriately we were cutting the size of the force, first with the Bush-based force and then the bottom-up review. Cut it about 40%. You can argue whether that was too much in some areas. But that was also the time when we took the procurement holiday and we cut procurement and modernization. I say we. There were some of us who screamed bloody murders. First speech I ever gave on the House floor was about this. We cut the procurement and modernization budget by much more and cut procurement by much more. So examples, helicopter procurement went down 90%, shipbuilding by two-thirds, fighters for the Air Force by 80%. And I say this, you know, I talk to lay people on this subject. I said, what would happen if UPS just decided to stop buying trucks for a few years? Well, you'd end up with a huge capital bow wave. And the longer it took you to deal with it, the further you push it out in the future, the bigger it would be when you finally did deal with it. And that's basically what we've been dealing with. It was exacerbated by the increasing op tempo, of which you are all aware. So we were using an aging inventory that we weren't replacing at much higher rates than we ever expected to. And that has caused, I believe, some of the issues with the acquisition process. It's weakened the defense industrial base. There were a lot of consolidations. You all remember that. You know, fewer competitors, less competition, harder to hold down prices. It's had an impact on the human capital in the defense industrial base. There was one year Joe Lieberman and I put money in the budget just to allow the shipyards to sustain the human capital so that they could design the next submarine if and when we got around to designing the next submarine, because we didn't want those people to go away. That's very hard to reconstitute. I think it's contributed to requirements creep. Because if you're one of the services and you're not going to be able to design and build as many platforms as you like to, you try and stuff as much into the few platforms that you can build, and I think it's contributed to an exacerbated inter-service rivalries over the years. So part of the solution, I think, is a sufficient and stable funding line going into the future, which is one of the reasons why the last independent panel strongly recommended returning at least to the Gates budget baseline that Secretary Gates proposed before he left office in the spring of 2011, and I think it's going to take more than that going forward. Now, internal problems, a lot of people have written about this. I mean, I really got into this from a different perspective than my congressional service when I served on the first independent panel. That was the Perry Hadley panel in 2010, and we studied this extensively. Reported on it, and those who had dealt with this in the past and worked with it, you know, concluded that the major problem was, and this is not going to surprise any of you, we said the fundamental reason for the continued underperformance in acquisition activities is fragmentation of authority and accountability for performance, and went on to make a number of recommendations. I still believe that that's true. You need a tight chain of command where people know they have authority commensurate with a responsibility, and that allows you to hold them accountable for performance. And that's why I liked what the NDAA is doing. I think it's pursuing the right line and the right principle, and I think it's trying to do so in real but modest ways. So I like the redefinition and reinforcing of the authority of the chiefs and the secretaries going forward. We have slipped into a situation where it's too much like having two bureaucracies in the department trying to do the same thing. And that's always a mistake. Oversight is one thing. Supplanting execution is another. And I think it makes sense that the services, who are, after all, constituted for that purposes, should be the ones going forward who have the responsibility and therefore the accountability. So it comes down, this would appeal very much to me if I'd still been in the Senate. If you think that the chiefs and the secretaries aren't doing the job adequately, the answer is not to create a competing bureaucracy which will try and do it at the same time they're doing it. The answer is to work with them, help them, and if that doesn't work, get people who can do the job. So clear responsibility, clear authority, And then clear accountability, I think, is the path forward. I liked the features of the bill providing for alternative pathways at the discretion of the secretary. I do think the chiefs tend to be focused by the nature of their job, either on the here and now, on satisfying the immediate needs of the combatant commanders, or on envisioning what the next generation, what the future 10, 12, 15, 20 years from now is going to look like for their services. And there is a tendency to give a little short shrift to the programs that you want to design and build in an intermediate time frame. I think it makes sense for the secretary to have some discretion to assign management for those programs to other agencies, not that he has to do it. I like the provision in the bill that emphasizes regrowing the services acquisition capabilities. I'm concerned about the graying of our acquisition workforce. I think it needs to be expanded, and we have to consider in the future beefing it up so that we can recapitalize the services when we get an adequate top line to do it, and real purpose and will both in the executive and the legislative branch to do it. And that has to come. I mean, we're at the point where we have to recapitalize these inventories going forward. I'm deeply concerned, as we said in the second independent panel, that we're going to very quickly have a force that's at high risk of not being able to carry out the national military strategy. I'll just conclude with one other point that I always try to emphasize to my colleagues about this, that I think we have to avoid, as we go through this process, unrealistic expectations that are inevitably going to be disappointed. I used to have this conversation with Senator Coburn all the time. He was a good friend of mine. My issue with the department was primarily defense funding, and Tom's was primarily defense waste. As any of you who know Tom, know that. He was very effective, a great senator, and a good friend. And I conceded, the points that he was making. But I always tried to tell him that you have to consider the context. I mean, the department is a part of government, okay? And so it is going to respond to legal dynamics, which the last speaker talked about, policy dynamics, and yes, some political dynamics and bureaucratic dynamics, which means it is never going to operate from a standpoint of pure economic efficiency the way a well-run private business operates. It can operate a lot better. I think it can and often does operate better than the rest of the government, but a plan that assumes it's going to run like a free market entity in a highly competitive part of the economy that's very well managed is a plan that is designed to fail, and all we're going to get is a lot of disappointment. So I like what you all are talking about. I like what the Senate's done and the House. We're going to move step by step forward, making it better one step at a time, and I think that will work. And I appreciate you all working with the Congress on it. We do need to continue promoting, the last speaker was right about this, an atmosphere of partnership and teamwork whenever possible, rather than an adversarial atmosphere or a hostile one. And I think we can get this job done. I did that in 10 minutes. It's not bad, given my background. So thank you all very much.
Our next speaker is Dr. Michael Hanlon of the Brookings Institute, a senior fellow. Michael's a longtime friend of ours and has been a featured speaker at a number of our Hill events, and we always appreciate you coming out. Michael also is a visiting lecturer at Princeton University as well as Johns Hopkins University. Thank you so much.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's an honor to be part of this great Lexington Institute event and to follow Senator Talent and other excellent remarks that I've heard so far. I think I'll try to do my remarks in 7 minutes, and I just really want to try to drive home a couple of central points that ultimately get to this issue of which kinds of technologies within the broader Department of Defense portfolio should we be trying to acquire in fundamentally different ways than we have been. And the way I'll begin is by telling a story about an event we had at Brookings in the spring, where I asked the same question to Undersecretary Kendall and then to Bill Lynn. Bill Lynn, of course, had been Deputy Secretary of Defense in the same Obama administration a little sooner, now runs the U.S. Arm of Finmeccanica. And the question was, how good of a grade would you give to American defense acquisition policy and process today. And Secretary Kendall, who was just putting out Better Buying Power 3.0 at that time and obviously has been a big advocate for improvement and therefore is hardly complacent about this issue, nonetheless said, let's give ourselves a little credit. Whenever we go to war, we have by far the best stuff in the world. It tends to work pretty well. And I would say maybe we deserve a B+, maybe even a little better. And then I asked the same question to Bill Lynn a little later in the setting, in the forum. And Bill said, I don't disagree with Undersecretary Kendall, but I think that I would make that grade more specific for major platforms, traditional systems. I think we do buy those pretty well. And yes, there are some overruns and inefficiencies, and we have all these bureaucratic issues to contend with, but nonetheless, we do pretty well. But anything touched by Moore's Law, we tend to do less well, and I'll give that a C-. We convened then another discussion group in October, and this one was off the record, so it was, you know, everybody was speaking freely, and just as Secretary Kendall and Lynn had been earlier in public. But nonetheless, the consensus there was that if we're going to look for certain areas to take Bill Lynn's idea and push it one step further, which areas of defense technology should we be trying to bring in new players? And should we be wondering if the whole system of highly regulated acquisition is perhaps too onerous? Now, there's a lot of room for reform, even within traditional platforms, but this group emphasized that information technology systems, autonomous systems, robotics, unmanned systems, these were the areas that were probably most promising because they tend to have a high content of cyber technology and software, and because they're relatively less expensive in terms of the platforms, the engines, the metal. And in other words, these are areas where the traditional defense base, the industrial base, is doing a pretty good job, and it's hard for new entrants to compete anyway. Whereas in the areas of information technology and robotics and autonomous systems, a little bit easier. Now, we all know it's hard to actually draw such clear lines. There's a lot of cyber infrastructure inside the biggest ships and planes, and there are some pretty important issues with engines and structure and metal inside of drones. So it's not as if you can neatly divide the world into these categories. But this is what I would submit to you today, that if we're looking for new entrants, and this is just one particular element of the broader acquisition debate we're having this afternoon, and so I'm not trying to cover the whole landscape, but if one question before the jury this moment is, which kinds of procedures do we need to fundamentally revamp and look for some new ways of doing business, it's probably true that in general in the areas of smaller robotics and information technology we have the most to benefit from encouraging new entrants using some of the other kinds of authorities, using some of the models we learned in the wars with, let's say, JIATO, the Joint IED Defeat Organization that built the MRAP and other such things, or that contracted for the MRAPs. Some of these models of more rapid, less structured, less formal acquisition probably apply best in certain specific technology domains. And the very last point I'll make before concluding, since I'm just trying to hit this one specific area and then leave to others to address the broader subject, I had a colleague at Brookings last year, Jason Tama, Coast Guard officer, on a one-year fellowship. He did a very nice study on acquisition reform, which you can find on our website, brookings.edu, and he went out to Silicon Valley. And again, we know a lot of very good defense firms are not in Silicon Valley and are doing very well without the help of Silicon Valley, at least not in a direct sense. But nonetheless, we know that in some of these areas that I've been discussing today, we would like to see new entrants, smaller firms, high-tech firms, complement the existing industrial base. And yet there's sometimes this sense that Silicon Valley doesn't want to interact with Washington. They get frustrated by it. They find it bureaucratic, burdensome. They don't like the whole Edward Snowden revelations. Privacy issues are hurting their ability to sell technology. But what Jason found is that, in fact, there are a lot of firms in Silicon Valley who are as patriotic as the next guy and who would actually like to get into this business, not so much because they see a huge opportunity to make a ton of money, because in contrast with traditional defense platforms, the kinds of information systems that you're going to sell to the Defense Department are probably going to be at a lesser scale, a smaller scale in most cases, than what the commercial marketplace is offering. So it's partly patriotism and the technical challenge of being able to take new subjects and new problems and contribute to the national defense. So I think these are the areas where we have to work harder to reach out. I think Ash Carter is doing a pretty good job in this regard. We've just got to keep at it. It's going to take a while. But I'll finish on the happier note that as much as all the reform ideas we're talking about today are necessary, I still come back to Secretary Kendall's thought that, at least for most traditional platforms, and I think I would agree with this, the current industrial base is doing a pretty good job. And so we should begin from a premise that the system is sort of three-fourths strong, one-quarter broken, instead of throwing the baby out with the bathwater. I'm not suggesting people here are trying to do the latter, but sometimes the conversations, the tones of broader national dialogues trend in a direction that suggests that the system is fundamentally broken. There are a lot of problems, a lot of issues. We need 3 hours today. I'll now defer to others for the other issues. But overall, we're doing pretty well. But let's try to get those new entrants in, especially in areas of IT and robotics. Thank you.
John, you're next. Our next speaker is John Etherton, president and owner of Etherton & Associates. John was an 18-year staffer in the U.S. Senate, including 14 years as a professional staffer on the Senate Armed Services Committee. He is also a former vice president for legislative affairs at the Aerospace Industries Association and a longtime acquisition reform activist and advocate. Great to see you, John.
Thank you
for coming.
Great. Thank you, Mac. We strive for an acquisition process that produces value for all the parties involved in it. But both the government and industry must understand and work with knowledge of the other's imperatives and the political and business environment in which they make decisions. Industry seems to have a much better sense of the government's operations and objectives than the government has of the environment in which industry has to operate. Over the years of working on the industry side of this divide, I have been repeatedly impressed by the range of complex factors that go into producing shareholder value, rather than merely focusing on single elements like contract profit. I believe a deeper appreciation on the part of the government of industry's imperatives could lead to a Pentagon customer better able to use incentives rather than compliance measures to get its products and services in a cost-effective manner while attracting a much broader segment of the private sector to the national security business. Once again, we point to clarity in requirements, timely decision-making, predictability in funding, business terms and conditions such as the treatment around the treatment of intellectual property, consistent and transparent yet flexible methods of determining value. These are the essential features of a well-functioning process, yet they seem over and over again to just kind of elude our grasp. The degree amongst the degree of consensus among reasonable people that you could get in a room about what a more effective acquisition process should look like has been repeatedly amazing to me every time we have a study on the topic. Given our long experience with the power of this intractable equilibrium that seems to persist in the current system, and this was very well described in a lot of his testimony by Paul Francis over at GAO, the real question is how do we start toward a different outcome? Ultimately, in my view, we need to get beyond clever problem statements, colorful band-aids, and a lot of vigorous hand-waving to identify and go after the root causes of the current dysfunction in the acquisition process. And in my opinion, there are several very, very difficult things that we need to take a look at. Let's first start with the budget process, including the Budget Office, the authorizers, the Appropriations Committees, OMB, and the DOD Comptroller, and the other agency financial managers. We need to be looking at this process with all of these folks in a comprehensive fashion for objective consideration of major changes that probably would upset a lot of very heavy rice bowls. In my opinion, the current budget and resource allocation process probably drives more stakeholder behavior in the current acquisition system than any other single factor. We also are in a situation, and others have already commented on this, where the oversight community is defining the rules and standards for success in the system, not merely enforcing what Congress has mandated in terms of its standards. And I see, think here of the disconnect that I see between where the IG seems to be on the issue of price reasonableness versus what Congress has mandated for that same issue on commercial item. Many of these organizations, like the DOD Inspector General, the Office of the Operational Test and Evaluation, are independent by statute and have no real institutional responsibility in the larger enterprise for individual program or procurement outcomes. The influence of the oversight community has fostered a very strong compliance culture in the workforce and in acquisition organizations, and the leadership that everyone seems to crave does not naturally grow out of this current environment. Oversight organizations cannot play more constructively in an enterprise-focused process, in my view, without candid and very difficult discussions about balancing priorities and perhaps consideration of changes to statutory mandates for these organizations. Another area I would point to is our people. Our people are key. The federal acquisition workforce needs to be transitioned from the current compliance-based transaction-by-transaction culture fostered by the current budget and oversight approaches that we have to looking at things from an enterprise view and with capabilities to effectively apply value approaches on behalf of the taxpayer across an entire acquisition life cycle and even multiple acquisition program life cycles. However, we have to recognize and look and considering this and what we do, that these people only have so much time and attention, and they're really burdened right now. There's a lot of work that they have to do, and that the workforce that we have now is the one, and the ones with the current roles will be our primary acquisition tools for the next 5 to 10 years. So we have to start someplace. We're not just going to be able to wipe the slate clean and start over. Effective education and other support, as well as change management, will be essential in this effort. If the provisions of the FY16 NDAA on the workforce with the Defense Acquisition Workforce Development Fund changes and some of the other authorities are any indication, Congress appears to be willing to provide any reasonable authorities and funding to help achieve a move in this direction if DOD will but request them and use them. We also need better data capture and analytics, as these are the only ways I can see for understanding the costs, including opportunity costs, of the system that we have now and all of its elements. Conclusive evidence of the magnitude of the cost of overhead, the oversight burdens, the cost of missed opportunities, and the cost of lost time and dollars could drive deep changes if all of the stakeholders were willing to collect the information, look at the information, and follow where the information leads. Well, I agree with Secretary Kendall on many issues. There's one area where I disagree, and that is that I do not believe we will make any progress thinking about acquisition and the issues and trying to transform the system if we view our mission as continuous improvement. The current system at its most improved would still be too slow, too cumbersome, and too costly to meet our emerging national security challenges. We must be intent from the start on driving foundational transformation and doing so for at least the next 5 to 6 years in order to force the acquisition system into a new equilibrium state. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Byron Callan, Managing Director of Capital Alpha Partners. Byron is a longtime financial market portfolio manager and analyst. He has previously worked at Lions Path Capital as well as Prudential Equity Group. He always brings a very good and unique financial market lens to this debate, and we're looking forward to your remarks. Thank you.
Thanks, Mac, and it's good to be back in another Lexington event. At the last one of these events in June, I talked about why I thought this time was really different for acquisition reform. And this time, Mac's charge was to talk about, you know, what could the DOD do to be a better customer. I'd like to point out that most of the comments I'm about to make really are aimed at the shorter cycle, kind of more technology dynamic parts of the DOD's portfolio, not necessarily the major platform programs, nuclear submarines or aircraft carriers. And I want to be encouraging here because I think there is a lot that's going on. The DOD does recognize some of these issues, and I think the NDAA embodied a lot of very important steps that are certainly going to be taken further in FY17. But I think as this event exemplifies, there's certainly more that needs to be done. So, you know, the first point, I think there's got to be a recognition that time is money. You know, we've got product development times that would kill most commercial companies. And I think along that same line, we're aware of the Valley of Death concept, this idea that these lengthy acquisition cycles, they just add cost to payrolls. Companies have to pay for people, maintain facilities, keep assets busy. And without recognizing that time is money, you're incurring costs on companies, particularly some of the smaller ones that are just going to keep them out of this market. I think kind of related to that second point, the concepts of time really need a reset. I was at the Reagan National Defense Forum this past weekend in Simi Valley, and I heard twice the MRAP program kind of held up as a model of how quickly the DOD could acquire systems. I've got a friend, Jim Hasek at the Atlanta Council, who's actually doing a PhD thesis on this, and I think he's figuring, you know, depending on where you start, it could be 3 to 7 years for the MRAP acquisition, or really kind of from the identification of the first requirement to when the production really took off. And I just don't think that the MRAP program should be an example of, you know, how quickly the acquisition system can respond to urgent needs. Someone else at the same conference made the comment that only in Washington, D.C. would 18 months be considered a short time. So keep that in mind. And again, just because the pace at which technology is moving, this concept of time, I think, very much needs a reset, too. Third point, I think it's important here not to create false expectations. Specifically, I'd look at DIUX, which was launched, you know, with a fair amount of fanfare back initially at Stanford University and then last August. My personal view, that effort's probably going a lot slower than most people would imagine in terms of staffing and engagement and how they're actually working this on the ground right now. It may have changed a bit, but the Army, I think, you know, with this network integration evaluation system that they had at Fort Bliss, also had, you know, a series of events encouraging companies to bring, you know, the best and their brightest down, let the soldiers play with it. And, you know, I had one CEO used to say, we got tired of doing science projects for the Army because there just wasn't anything that was coming out of this. So put some money behind where some of these acquisitions are going to go. So, you know, if there is going to be something there and people will get a return for it, again, that's part of not creating the false expectations part. The third point, really the fourth point, I guess, Phil touched on this, and I think it's important, is really offer appropriate returns for appropriate risk. I do a lot, you know, looking at defense contractor margins, looking at technology company margins. I'd point out in, you know, some of the cyber companies, for example, the publicly traded ones, FireEye, Palo Alto Networks, these companies, if you look at their financial statements, they're not reporting any profit right now. But if you drill up into their gross margins, which is really the cost to, you know, deliver their product, it's not the marketing and the research and development costs, they're earning 70% margins. But they're also putting 20% of their sales into research and development. And if I were DOD, you know, I'd like to have the advantage of that, that investment and the type of people that, frankly, are attracted to that sort of investment. So I really do think that, you know, this whole debate, look, everything shouldn't get the same uniform return, but particularly in some of these areas where DOD is going to have to compete against the commercial sector and bring in some of the commercial sector, the margins are going to matter. Another point, I don't think, you know, the non-defense sector should be treated as foreign territory. I've heard some people talk about DIUX as an embassy in Silicon Valley, and I don't know if any of you have seen embassies lately. The U.S. has put in different countries, but, you know, Walmart, General Electric, they don't talk about embassies in Silicon Valley. They talk about their offices for outreach. So that may be a little bit of semantics, but kind of related to that, I think probably the DOD, you know, instead of just relying on federal business opportunities to explain what they're up to, maybe there's a little bit more translation that could be done to translate what kind of problems, big picture problems the DOD has, and how that might bring in some of the people in the Valley and, frankly, the rest of the country to work on this. Final thought here, I think DOD probably has more of an agility problem and not necessarily an innovation problem. I think a lot of the technology is there. It's in the country. It's in the lab system. It's in the heritage defense contractors. The trick is just getting it quickly enough into the Department of Defense. So, you know, as Phil pointed out in his introductory remarks, you've got something that's going to make the warfighter more effective. There are two things, just in conclusion, that I don't see as important, and maybe these strike a kind of, you know, mom and apple pie issues that I hear a lot in the acquisition discussions. The first is, I don't necessarily think the DoD has to be more stable and predictable, at least compared to other commercial enterprises. Yes, that's true for big, long production timelines for major weapons platforms, but stable and predictable is kind of contrary to innovative and agile. And just as a thought on this, I'd highly recommend a book called The End of Competitive Advantage by Rita McGrath. She's a professor at Columbia University. This is written about how companies are responding to this quickly changing world, but I think it's worth a read for anybody in this room who's interested in how to think about this in a defense content. And finally, I don't think the DoD necessarily has to be a fair buyer. Mr. Kendall made that remark at the Reagan National Defense Forum last week. Personally, look, if a company brings a great idea or product and it meets an urgent need or an unrecognized requirement, I'd reward them. And I very much appreciate a comment that Peter Newell made recently. He was the former head of the Army Rapid Equipping Initiative. He noted that the last time I was shot at, being fair wasn't the first thing that came to mind.
We are always fortunate to have Phil O'Dean join us as a featured speaker at our forum. You've been very helpful in the past several times, and glad to see you again. Phil is the former chairman and CEO of TRW. He's also the former CEO of BDM, two terrific defense companies. He's now currently on the Defense Business Board, the Chief of Naval Operations Executive Panel, and we're glad to have you here and look forward to your remarks. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, and it's a pleasure to be back, and I've talked to these groups a couple times in the past and enjoyed today, especially the early speakers, and I'm sure I'll enjoy the rest. I do plan to hang in here and listen to all of them. My theme today is that acquisition reform is not just important, but I think it's essential to the future capabilities and U.S. technology and our military dominance. We simply have to get this right. Every year, the Hill or the Pentagon or somebody comes out with a new agenda for defense reform. And yet, if I look back over my years, I'm not sure we're any more effective today than we were back at the time of the Packard Commission or Bill Perry's initiatives in the 1990s. And Phil, I think your comments on FAR Part 12 kind of a real case in point for that particular point. And others have talked about many of the other problems that we face. So let me just talk first very briefly about some of the challenges facing the traditional acquisition system. And then I want to shift to the real focus today of my talk, which is reaching out to the small, innovative, rapidly moving technology companies across the country. First, in terms of the current system, and I think Jim Talent made this point first as well, there's a real lack of clear lines of authority and responsibility. You know, the old too many cooks spoil the broth thing is absolutely applicable here. You've got to know who's in charge, who's responsible, and then you have to hold them accountable. And if you don't hold people accountable, you're never going to have good results. And I think if you look at the turnover in program managers and PEOs and the people that are in theory responsible, it's not a very pretty picture. Secondly, the incentives are misaligned. Affordability is not incentivized. It should be very high in the incentive list. The focus is on getting the program underway, getting the dollars flowing, et cetera. Third, few programs, big programs, are started off right. Costs and schedules are unrealistic. Technology is often immature, and there's excessive concurrency. This leads to change orders, delays, and cost growth. And finally, related to this, operational requirements are seldom well-defined, and the performance expectations are often very unrealistic. Lacking these, you're not going to have a good outcome. And again, you'll have more change orders, schedule slippage, and cost growth. Given these factors, and others have talked about this, probably no surprise that we've had many disappointments in large programs, although, as I think point made, that many of them have been successful in the wrong run and have worked well in combat. But let me refocus and talk about another major challenge, and that's DOD's limited ability to reach out to the rapidly moving high technology companies all around the country that are really changing the landscape. The Moore's Law companies, I think somebody said, was a nice way to define it. And DOD has very limited capacity to tap into these companies for a lot of reasons. I think everyone would agree that DOD lags the commercial sectors in a bunch of areas, whether it's cyber, whether it's robotics, whether it's rapid innovation, whether it's use of big data, Internet of Things, and on and on and on. And these are areas where the commercial sector dominates, and DOD simply has to access this technology if we want to make our forces as capable and effective as they should be. And I think we all recognize that potential enemies are often much more agile than we are in tapping into this sort of thing. I don't want to say that DOD has no cutting-edge technology. They have, and I think this has been mentioned in talking about major systems. If you're looking at nuclear propulsion, stealth, high-speed, supersonic aircraft, these areas, DOD has great technology and something that has, in fact, been effective over time. But even in these areas, access to commercial technology would absolutely help them as well in the future. The intelligence community recognizes this, and they've reached out to the technology community, and they have a vehicle called InQtel that I'm sure you're all familiar with. It's been quite successful in a relatively narrow set of areas, but it has worked. But on the other hand, it serves a unique set of customers. They tend to be much more open to new technologies. They're not as risk-averse as the Pentagon tends to be. And because of the nature of the mission, they're not as open to criticism, oversight, and so forth. So they can make things happen sometimes that would be difficult elsewhere. As you may know, other parts of the Pentagon are now trying to emulate this and looking at setting up their own version of InQtel. I think it's a good move. It may work, but I am not sure it can be successful simply because they don't have the same attributes the intelligence community has in terms of the willingness to take risks and to incur risk and move quickly like the intelligence community has been able to do. The other point brought up was Secretary Carter's Silicon Valley initiative. What was that Byron said? The embassy in Silicon Valley, which was an interesting way to look at it. I think it's an important initiative. I think it has the potential to make a difference. But it's very early yet, obviously. We don't know how it's going to work out. We all are very hopeful that it'll work. Let me suggest a few reasons why I think we should temper our enthusiasm for this effort. First, small innovative companies may well want to work for DOD, but unfortunately they don't trust the Department of Defense. They see far more downside than upside in working for the Department of Defense. Tales of DOD bureaucracy, concerns about ITAR, worries about intellectual property, all of these stories are legion, and they all hear them and know about them and are concerned about them. And another factor is these companies do not need capital. Most of them are well capitalized, so they're not desperate for DOD dollars in order to be successful. And if they are successful, the markets they're going to appeal to are commercial markets, including many, many international markets. And these markets will dwarf any dollars the Department of Defense can put in their pockets over time. And they simply don't want to put these potential markets at risk by dealing with DOD. Another factor, again, this has been Brent mentioned, if DOD is to exploit this new technology, these non-traditional companies, they have to streamline their acquisition policies. There are plenty of potential in the FAR. FAR Point 12 has been mentioned. The Defense Authorization Bill gives additional authority and capability. But these things have to actually be used and not simply be in somebody's acquisition bookcase. And the acquisition workforce has a lot of trouble dealing with this type of supplier. They simply are not trained. You go to the Defense Acquisition University, there's very little, almost no training in using FAR Part 12 and these other flexible uses, ways, fast track kind of flexible policies. And the workforce is also, I think everybody recognizes, risk adverse. And stepping out and using these policies, taking creative kind of approaches, does incur risk, and people, for good reason, I think, worry about that. In addition, you have to worry about the technical workforce of the Department of Defense, its labs. If we're going to adapt this technology, the labs are going to have to play a role incorporating into our weapons and equipment. And the workforce there has aged. yet a lot of it is atrophied, and because of hiring and other problems, there has been very few infusions of young people with fresh technology, fresh ideas, and fresh ways of thinking. I'm sorry to be negative about this, because I'm hopeful that initiatives will succeed. And I'm encouraged by the passion and energy that Secretary Carter is putting behind this initiative. If he has the time to sustain this effort, and he only has another, year and a half to go, but if he has the time to sustain it, and he can get the full support of other parts of the Pentagon, which may be a challenge. There are also rumors floating around that there's a lot of opposition down in the weeds to these initiatives. But if he has that time and the ability to really get the full support of the Pentagon behind him, I think it can make a difference. But it's not going to succeed business as usual. I think the best hope would be to put a very senior person, somebody with the clear support of Secretary Carter and AT&L, Undersecretary AT&L, with a major time effort to push this effort. He's got to ride herd on the acquisition workforce, make sure they'll use these flexible acquisition policies. When roadblocks appear, and they will appear, he's got to step in and break them down. And if you can do this, I think there's a fair chance that this initiative can succeed. But it's not going to do it unless you have some particular focused effort by people at a very, very senior level. You know, if this does begin to work, and I hope it will, we ought to look beyond Silicon Valley. There are a number of other areas in the country where very outstanding technical expertise is in the academic community in particular. Think of Boston with the MIT culture, robotics, fast data, all of the sort of things that are being done in that area could be of great help to the Department of Defense. Another important area is San Diego, which has become the center of biotechnology research in the country. And again, areas of interest to Pentagon. And they should think about reaching out to those areas as well if they can find a way to make these kinds of initiatives work. So let me close with this and say again, thank you for the time today. I appreciate the chance to be here, and I look forward to hearing the other speakers as well.
Thank you very much, Phil. You folks in the back, we've got some seats up here if you want to have a seat. You can ignore the signs on the seats and come on up and have a seat if you'd like. Our next speaker is our very own Dan Goure, Vice President of the Lexington Institute. Dan has got the lead for us on acquisition reform issues. He's done a fabulous job in recent years on this issue. He is a former, has had key positions at the Office of Secretary of Defense, as well as CSIS, and several other important organizations. And Dan, looking forward to your remarks.
Thanks. Thank you, Mac. And it's really an honor to be here associated with such marvelous speakers and experienced people. I'm not sure, you know, if I paid you enough for the ability to be on the stage of this group. You know, as I'm listening to everything that's been said and thinking back over the stuff I've read and the work I've done, I don't get it. I don't get why DOD has such a problem getting what it wants at the price it wants and the quantity it wants. It runs the show, right? It's the 800-pound gorilla in the defense marketplace, not just in the United States, obviously, but globally, right? Moreover, it writes the rules. It defines the terms of the engagement. It does the oversight. It has excess data. I mean, if you were a private company competing in the marketplace, you know, for pick your product, and you were going to go out and buy it, and you had access to the kind of preferential rules, regulations, and all the rest, and information, well, first of all, you'd be in jail because it would be considered to be kind of illegal. But, you know, I mean, talk about the art of the deal, to bring it into modern political terms. Wow. And so it's a puzzle here that was sort of, and I've been thinking about it, why is this the case? Yes, you know, there are problems of miscommunication or differences of interest that do exist between the Defense Department and the providers of services. There are issues or examples of waste, fraud, and abuse, although one would have to point out, given the magnitude of budgets, the number of contracts, the incidents, the demonstrated incidents of real waste, fraud, and abuse, other than programs that go south, which is not quite the same thing, are relatively rare. Moreover, one would have to assume, right, have to believe that if in fact more oversight, more intervention, more agencies, more assessments, all of that stuff, more rules, right? The increase in the number of regulations were, in fact, the answer, then there had to be at this point, 30 years, almost 40 years after the Packer Commission, a direct correlation between the rise in all of those input factors, if you will, and, you know, better performance, right? I mean, you would have to assume that you could sort of watch the number of regulations go up and the, you know, cost or the, you know, per item cost of defense goods go down. There's no relationship. And in fact, I know there's even been an IDA study done for the Undersecretary of Defense for AT&L that basically says, you know what, there's no correlation. The only correlation we can figure out between the way programs, I mean, I'm being very simplistic in this, but notice, between the way the programs sort of eventuate and their ability to keep closer or farther from schedule and cost is a function of the budget situation when they started. If you had a kind of rich budget situation, then everybody didn't lie as much about schedule and cost, to put it bluntly. And if it was a really tight competitive budget environment, they tended to gild the lily somewhat more, and therefore you had a greater chance of things not lining up. But, you know, all the precise navigation orders. So it struck me here at this point that really we're not just talking about sort of the problem of acquisition reform and making DOD a better buyer. I mean, I'm all for efforts to do that. But, you know, with this focus now, particularly over the last 7 years, on better buying power, version 1, version 2, version 3, we've tended to forget the other side of this, which is DOD is not merely a buyer. It is also a customer. And there's a difference between a buyer and a customer. All right? And there's also a difference between being a good customer and a bad customer. Now, in the business management literature, there's a lot of stuff about good customer service and how you deal with customers, how you improve service and, you know, all the work, and even how you deal with bad customers. But, you know, it's interesting. I came up with, there were some articles that sort of define sort of characteristics of bad customers. And let me just give you a couple of those. Go for it. One example, this is a list that was put out by at least one article, but I thought it was illustrative. First data point, you know, if you meet these criteria, you're a bad customer. So I think it's right. One, swaps vendors in the industry and boasts about it. Okay? The staff complains about it. It's the staff of the service provider, right? On the other hand, the customer is abusive to the staff or complains about the people they're being serviced by. Payment issues, late payment, non-payment, changing payment rules, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Adding or changing the scope of work during a project. This is on the commercial side, but this is an article that had nothing to do with defense, right? Lack of availability. There's two sides. You had customers who were constantly sort of in your short, so to speak, and you're constantly hectoring the provider for all kinds of things, big, small, kind of couldn't think for themselves. But the other case was, you know, customers where you couldn't communicate, even when there was an essential issue that had to be decided. And the last one on this list, at least, was tries to game the system. Now, other articles have added things like, for example, always assuming that the service provider is wrong, that the problem is never on the side of the buyer, in this case, or the customer. It's always the provider that gets it wrong. And the second one, which is related, is always assuming a victim's status. And I've heard a lot in the last several years about this sort of adversarial relationship between DOD and the private sector. I mean, it can be overblown in some respects, but I think it is real. It's not just this adversarial. Some adversarial relationship is probably good, but it is this notion that the government is being victimized in many respects by an industrial base. Now, somehow it's only the defense industrial base and all the commercial items that come in from the much larger, you know, pens to socks and all kinds of other things from the non-defense industrial base, that's okay, and that's, you know, everybody in that industrial base is honest and okay, and then somehow in the defense industrial base, they're not. But that sense of victimhood not only sort of means that you don't look at your own part in the problem, but it also means that you are establishing a relationship where communications becomes more and more difficult. You know, there's an analogy here. I was sort of thinking of a TV show. There's a great TV show I watched a couple of times about a bridal boutique. and all the problems you have. You know, the would-be bride comes in, and she brings in the mother-in-law and the mother, and then the bridesmaids and a sister or two, and you know, they're going back and forth on this, and everybody has an opinion. And by the way, if you go from one fitting to the next, the cast of characters behind the bride will change. And then, of course, if it was kind of bring it to Washington, you have 535 friends of the bride, all who come into the room, all who want to say something about the length of the sleeves or the, you know, the back and all the rest. And then, oh, by the way, between the first fitting and the last, and without telling the bridal gown designer, the bride puts on 30 pounds and then can't understand why she can't fit into the dress she ordered. So there is a piece here which is about being a good customer. And on a number of issues, by the way, when we're talking about timelines, this is an interesting thing about timelines, it was mentioned by several people, which really matters. When it takes you years to formulate a requirement because of the laboriousness of the process, you are, as we've had examples of, likely to be out of date, not just with technology, but within the world stage, as things are moving rather more rapidly than our timelines. And when you're talking about can't write the contract, let it out, for, let's say, software, in less than 18 months to 2 years, when the technology is changing on the level of 6 months, there is something wrong, and it's not with the vendors, right? This is not about money. It's not about price. It's not about margins. We're simply here talking about things like timelines. Companies are ready to go on something, and they wait. They wait for the RFI, the RFP, the final. They wait for the award. And by the way, even on awards, you can spend 6 months past the promised date waiting for an award to come out. If time is money or time is lives when it comes to the military, this too is unacceptable. And then you have problems where we haven't factored in issues on the customer side of the cost as well as the lethality, if I can call it that, of things we now do kind of not only post-award but into production. So, for example, operational test and evaluation. Got to have good test and evaluation. There's no question. But at what point does it become an interference with schedule? At what point does dotting that last I and crossing that last T, particularly on major programs that you know are going to be around for 50 years and you know are going to go through endless cycles of upgrades that will correct whatever deficiency you find on the first go-round, at what point does that become not just counterproductive but a threat to national security? So all this is a way of saying, you know, yeah, you have to think about buying power. There has to be an ability of the government to have some reasonable confidence that it's getting a fair deal. Maybe you even want to argue on military items the best deal possible. But the government also needs to recognize that it determines to a large extent the nature of the playing field, at least for defense goods and services. And if things are too slow, cost too much, don't come out the way the government wants it, the first place the government needs to look is not at industry, but at itself. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dan. Our next speaker is Ken Miller, a terrific friend of the Lexington Institute for many years. Thank you very much for coming, Ken. Ken was an aerospace engineer for Naval Air Systems Command for most of his career. He fought his way all the way up to the Senior Executive Service, where he provided advice on acquisition-related issues for a variety of aircraft and weapon systems, and finished off his federal career as a Special Assistant for Acquisition for the United States Air Force. He's president of KEM and Associates, and it's great to see you. Thanks for coming, Ken.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks, Matt.
Like Mac said, I've worked in government for like 35 years. And then I got out and I worked in the private sector for about 6 years. So for me to be listening to everybody talk about improving the acquisition process, to me it's kind of interesting because in my view, I don't think there's anything new out there. I don't think there is any silver bullets to solve any problems. I think that what we really need to do is think as to whether or not the process we have right now really needs to be improved, or just do we need to execute it better? In my view, you need about four things to kind of make the whole acquisition business process work. You need to have the requirements sorted out. You need to have a good sense and a good infrastructure on the acquisition side. You need to be able to have the great interface with Congress and the budget side. And you also have to have the right alignment with the private sector. My view is that improving this whole process is improving the congruency and harmonization of all four of those communities. I can sit here and I can spend hours talking about all four of those areas. But since I have about 9 minutes left, I'll probably just spend a couple of minutes on each one and give you what I think are the key highlights from my experience to be successful in those areas. On the requirements side, you must clearly understand what is required, why, and when. You need to know what performance is wanted and have a clear requirement analysis to be able to identify where the good enough breakpoints are, more than the today's threshold and objective process. I also think one of the things we do is we always come up with solutions that are point solutions. There is a lot of opportunity to do more analysis on looking how we can look across applications to solve more than one problem. In my experience, when you get requirements right, you have a better chance of program success. Now, one of my favorites, acquisition. Having a better trained and experienced acquisition workforce is probably one of the most important things. Using the right type of contract for the right type of program. Here's another big one. Clear accountability for program managers, PEOs, and SAEs. When you have success, reward them. When you don't, change them out. Here's a little anecdote. When I was working in NAVAIR 1,000 years ago as a program manager, it was incumbent upon us to always make sure you were on a program that was executing well, because if you didn't execute well, you'd probably be replaced. You could get replaced in those days because we had a strong acquisition pipeline and you had a lot of other people experienced to take your place. Nowadays, we're just getting by. The third area, the good old budget in Congress. We never seem to have enough of money for everything, but there's some things we could do probably a little differently. And here's one that I used to do, and I regret doing it when I was on the budget side, and that was provide better program budgeting stability by getting away from death by 1,000 cuts. Also, embrace more block buys on large capital investment programs. And then here's another one that I think is also very important. Allow for the ability for the program manager to budget at a higher confidence level and allow them to use and keep some of their management reserve. Nowadays, if your program manager comes in and you try to put in management reserve, that's probably the first thing you take. I know when I was in the budget community, that would be the first thing I would take. If I didn't take it, somebody else was going to take it after me. So finally, in the private sector, and I've had a very interesting opportunity to work in this area for about 6 or 7 years, so I now have a broader view of this problem from that standpoint. You need to have better discussions during the draft RFP stage between the government and private sector. I've seen some scenarios lately where the government has gotten to the point where they're afraid to talk even in the draft RFP stage. So we don't really have enough clear communication back and forth. I also think there needs to be better alignment up front between the private sector and the government and the R&D world. Right now, the requirements sometimes get totally mismatched. Now, here's my favorite one before I can get off the stage. I think it's probably the most important one. I think we've lost the meaning of best value. Best value, in my opinion, is now driven by the austere budget requirements to a selection process where lowest cost has become, by default, the primary, and in some cases, the only selection criteria. When you do that, you're defeating the entire purpose of best value, and you're cultivating an environment of behavior resulting in sub-optimized selections. So in conclusion, after 40 years, you know, I can kind of throw rocks at a lot of different areas because I've been there and I've seen it, so I have a biased view of them. So in conclusion, no new ideas, nor a single bullet, but really it takes solid execution of all of the communities I've talked about. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Ken. Our next speaker is Pat Tracy from Hewlett-Packard Enterprise Services. Pat is a retired vice admiral, and in her long, distinguished Navy career, she had many terrific jobs, including director of the Navy staff, and we are looking forward to your remarks. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mac. I'm not going to pretend to be as much of a student of acquisition history or acquisition reform as most of the people in this room. I draw from three perspectives when I think about what ought to change in the realm of acquisition. First, I was asked to lead a review of the sufficiency of acquisition authorities in connection with the 2006 QDR, a QDR that took place as DOD was ramping up its use of rapid acquisition authorities. Second, in my current role, success depends on helping to lead teams to navigate this acquisition system to earn the opportunity to deliver services, and then later to sustain the ability to deliver to the actual versus the competed requirements. And I'm doing that inside of an organization that is a Silicon Valley-based company, that is a largely commercial company, and where the Packard of the Packard Commission designed the governance process. So keep that in mind. Third, I was a director of the Navy staff at the beginning of the Navy's large transformation program, the Navy Marine Corps Internet program. In that role, in that seat, I got to see firsthand how important senior leader engagement on all four corners of the acquisition process are important to the success of any complex program. I come at acquisition reform with a lot more questions than I do answers. There's absolutely no doubt that a successful acquisition outcomes are more important today than they have been any other time in our lives. Threats and potential adversaries are proliferating. Technology disruptions are happening at an accelerated pace, and they both advantage us and confuse us. And they are lowering the thresholds to entry to sophisticated operations that were once thought the purview of only a few nation states. Budgets leave very little room for sustaining duplicative or overlapping capabilities. And nth order effects are manifesting themselves more rapidly, and they matter. The environment demands an acquisition process that is speedy, flexible, and predictable with regard to its outcomes, attributes that compete with each other and not in very meaningful ways. As we contemplate reforming the acquisition system, it's not clear to me that the most important changes can come with either legislative or regulatory changes. Are we confident that both government and industry participants understand all of the authorities that exist in the FAR, all of the flexibility that actually exists in the FAR? Do they understand the scenarios under which they are most applicable? Is there a shared understanding among the acquisition practitioners, amongst the contracting officers, amongst the requirements writers, and amongst the program managers so that they can work together to achieve the real end user's requirements? Are we encouraging industry to be similarly familiar with those authorities so that they can understand what flexibilities exist and how to let their customer understand how to exercise those flexibilities that matter? More than knowledge in exercising those authorities, it takes courage, and it takes senior leader engaged involvement to enable the practitioners to actually navigate the kinds of processes that are departing from the norm. Industry as well needs to reevaluate our risk equation to know that we can actually be ready to perform in a government in an era of profound and continuous uncertainty. The system today is characterized by deep distrust and chronic defensiveness at every level and at all sides. Are the leaders today visibly engaged throughout the life cycle of the programs to support innovation and cross-discipline collaboration so that practitioners can build some confidence in using these unusual and more fluid acquisition processes? Are oversight processes engineered to encourage purposeful creativity, or are practitioners motivated to find the best way to acquire that will eliminate the need to escalate to the next higher level for approval of something that is a little bit different, a little bit harder, a little bit more comprehensive? Courage and cross-discipline engagement by leaders are more important here than our regulatory and legal changes. It's exciting to see some of the changes that are happening in some areas to enable the rapid acquisition of important IT capabilities, the ways in which some parts of agencies and some contracting shops today are exercising some of the unusual aspects of the FAR. Are all government parties aware of what it takes to be successful under those circumstances? Are we helping industry to understand what success and goodness will look like under those acquisition processes? What can we learn from the ongoing proactive, collaborative oversight aimed at accelerating outcomes that characterizes those kinds of unusual acquisitions? My experience is that both government and industry would benefit from reviewing our procedures to know that we can actually be successful in those engagements. Second, acquisition domains drive really different measures of success. Acquiring the next offset capability for defense is really different from acquiring a multi-year services contract. Acquiring lawn and facilities maintenance is really different from acquiring IT services at an enterprise scale. Acquisitions that depend on or will generate organizational or behavioral changes require a very different kind of engagement by the acquiring organization than those that are buying commodity services. Is it time to think about emphasizing individuals and oversight processes that are specifically tailored to comprehending the unique aspects of each of those kinds of categories of acquisition? Is it sufficient for the key members of an acquisition team to only comprehend generic measures of cost, schedule, and performance and not understand what external factors might actually affect the performance of a program to the end user's benefit or to their risk? Would it be beneficial to encourage outreach and collaboration between government contracting experts in both industry and government? Third, there's widespread agreement that we do better when we have open dialogue about what the requirements actually are, that every acquisition would benefit from more thorough communication between those who wish to bid and those who are trying to procure. Should the government make more use of downselects in order to be able to sharpen the dialogue with those bidders whose proposals appear to align the best to the government's requirements? Is industry ready to accept that dialogue won't be even and won't be equal under those circumstances? Would it be helpful if leaders reviewed hard the decisions that are made about government members participating in industry forums where current and future trends are discussed, where government might have a chance to influence those trends if they were free to participate? Is the policy interpretation as it's being applied today suited to the government's need to reach out to more providers, to have a bigger influence around the technology trends that are underway? Taxpayers deserve an acquisition system that will with high probability, put the right capabilities into the hands of the men and women who are charged to execute the missions they are assigned on their behalf at the right time and in the right quantities to be successful. They deserve that such a system will pay only what's necessary to produce that outcome with high probability. Law and regulation alone will not achieve that outcome. It does take courage, and it takes senior leader involvement on all four corners throughout the life cycle of our programs. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Steve McCarthy from the UK Embassy here in Washington. He's the Minister of Defense Material. There's a huge ocean between the United States and the UK, and on procurement issues, there is an even bigger gulf between the way your government conducts matters and our government does. And as you're about to find out, we're looking forward to your remarks. Thank you very much for coming, Steve.
Thanks to Mac and the Lexington team for inviting me back again. My job here is twofold. One, to give you a funny British accent just to break up the day. Secondly, to reassure you that you are not alone and that acquisition problems in defense are not a feature unique to the United States. In the UK, we've had a very long history of just as many problems. It's sometimes said that Samuel Pepys started procurement reform in the UK in the 17th century. My minister is very fond of saying we're expecting the results any day soon. So our history has also been one of an apparent endemic sense of overruns of costs and long delays. And that's the impression that many people in the UK have about the way in which we do defence procurement, just like as some speakers have said already, you have here. But also, as others have already said today, the facts are slightly different in my country than they are in that sort of public rhetoric. Our National Audit Office, the equivalent of your GAO, just last month recognised that progress is finally being made with the cost of our top programs, our top 20 programs, reducing by $600 million and our best performance on time, i.e. lack of slippage, since 2001. That means that we are making progress finally. It doesn't mean that everything is bad. But what I thought I'd do for the rest of my time here, which I thought might be most useful, was to say, as well as the familiarities we have, and the same problems we have with the things that you struggle with, is what things we do that are more different than happens here in the US. I think that the first of these is one that's already been referred to by a number of speakers, and that's the whole issue of budgetary discipline. In 2010, when the then new British government arrived, it carried out its major defence review, and as part of that, and as part of its development of its longer-term economic plan across the whole of government, make some very serious decisions on major reductions in future programming in order to do one thing and one thing only, and that was to balance the budget we had before between our forward program and the cash we had to spend. There were some painful decisions in there. It meant we had to take capability or risk and capability gaps in a number of areas, but what it meant is that today we now have a programmed and formal and conserved contingency provision of around $7 billion over the next 10 years, and about an additional $12 billion worth of headroom later years for the forward program. That contingency is fundamentally important to us because all programs eventually suffer some form of risk and some form of slippage, and the ability to deal with that centrally rather than put the impact back on the program makes us more able to be flexible than we have been in previous years. The next big change I thought I'd mention is that we've been very consciously injecting private sector enterprise into our acquisition organization. That isn't the issue about using different contractors. It isn't the issue about finding new ways of developing and benefiting from new technologies. It's actually using expertise from the private sector in our buying arm. And one of the ways we've done that is to establish our procurement organization, Defense Equipment and Support is its title, as a thing that in our treasury jargon is called a bespoke trading entity. What that means is the procurement business for us is in a separate organization that is disciplined and kept deliberately apart from the people that set the requirements. It also means, and I'll come back to this in a minute, they have much more flexibility in terms of their ability to pay people and reward them in order to keep their services. But as I say, most importantly, we call the ENS now an arm's length body. And that does one most important thing, which is insert discipline between their relationship, into their relationship between them as the supplier and the services as the customer. Because in our view, picking up something that Dan was saying earlier on, it's the customer's lack of discipline that's where many of the historic problems in procurement have originated. Like you, we've also over the years enjoyed enormously the centralised or decentralised debate. It goes on in about a 10-yearly cycle and the pendulum swings one way or the other. Like you, we've recently been going through a process of deciding whether or not the service authority should have more power to determine their own future and their own requirements and deliver their own capabilities. And where we currently sit since 2010 is that our armed services do indeed have the authority now to develop their own procurement programs and, most importantly, again, as others have said, have the accountability for the delivering them. What that means for us is that while the MOD Centre still plays an overall important role in setting the forward program, what our ambition is for future capabilities, it's the services who set the requirements, who have the freedom to prioritise their manpower, equipment and training requirements, to balance off between those things and to deliver in the best way they see fit the objectives set for them at departmental level. And most importantly, perhaps, it's the chiefs of staff of those services who are held personally accountable for delivering on those objectives. So if an army program goes wrong, the person that gets it in the neck for that is the chief of staff of the army, the chief general staff in our terms. Our acquisition organization, DNS, as I said, has also been going through a significant transformation. One of the things that we've done is introduce commercial transformation partners into the organization to help them with specific work packages. For example, we have now Bechtel advising on maritime and air domain programs, CH2M Hill doing the same for land and joint enablers. These people are not managing the programs, but what they are doing is providing an alternative and distinct voice to program executives to say, are you sure you're doing this the right way, and have you thought about alternative ways of doing things? It's not just in equipment that we're doing that. We also have service providers helping in our infrastructure organization, for example, looking at the best way we manage our estate and trying to find new ways to improve the efficiency with which we run our infrastructure. A key factor that arm's length arrangement has enabled our procurement arm to get into, as I alluded to earlier on, is recruiting and retaining skilled staff. And a number of speakers already mentioned this morning. So we now have in that organisation more authority to pay market rates to compete with industry, to incentivise people to improve their performance, to allocate staff to tasks where their skills are most suited so people don't get stuck in the same old business doing the same old things, and to better match workforce demands with the needs that we have. So what that meant in simple terms is we had to break our acquisition organisation out from the normal civil service rules on employment and pay. So folk there get better rewarded for better tasks, but they also get fired more easily if they don't perform. Another important transformation in our acquisition organisation, which I think is also slightly different than has been the case here, is an increasing use of commercial providers to deliver most of the services that we used to do internally, for example, in areas of defence logistics. In 2014, in December, we sold our defence support group, who now, an organisation run by Babcock, do all of the maintenance, repair, overhaul and storage of all of our current military vehicles and light weapons. In April of this year, Leidos won a 13-year contract valued at about $11 million, to run and improve efficiency in warehouse procurement and stock control of food, clothing, general and medical supplies. We just don't think we need to own those services in the department. We think they're much better provided by commercial companies who know how to do this as part of their core business. And lastly, in the sort of commercial space over the last 20 years or so, we've increasingly sought to buy outcomes and not products. Examples that are now in place are that our tanker aircraft, our military communication satellites, and our fast jet pilot training are all now provided as services. We don't own the aircraft or the satellites. We buy refueling, we buy trained pilots, and we buy bandwidth. That means that the risk of servicing, providing, maintaining, and keeping updated those particular provisions is all held by our service providers. We just look to get the outcome. That does one very important and interesting thing that I don't think anyone has touched on today, which is, as well as the search for commercial providers that are outside of the normal defense markets in terms of technology, whether it's robotics or computing or all the things that we've talked about already today, it also brings into the defense field, in our case, service providers that really genuinely know how to provide a service, not just how to provide defense equipment. And that's an important distinction for us. But I'll close by saying that I think the biggest single factor in us in the last two decades or so in bringing down the costs and the performance of our acquisition programs at the major end of the scale has been embracing open international competition, which I think is arguably the most basic acquisition reform of all. The issue of competition internationally, of course, raises tough questions about sustaining your industrial base and about retaining operational sovereignty. But as can be seen, not least from the very wide number of US platforms and UK's portfolio of equipment, most of those concerns are mitigated by buying stuff from our closest allies and making sure that our industrial bases are very closely interwoven. We think that approach is wholly consistent with our defense policy, which is fundamentally international in nature. Byron referred earlier on to not talking about the commercial world as though it was a foreign government. My final message would stop telling your foreign government allies that they're foreign governments and treat them as part of your base too. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Steve. Our next speaker is Greg Kiley, the president of Kiley & Associates. Greg is a former professional staff member on the Senate Armed Services Committee, former defense analyst at the Congressional Budget Office, and a retired C-130 pilot in the U.S. Air Force, as well as a U.S. Air Force maintenance officer. Good to see you, Greg.
Thanks for coming. It's good to see everyone. As I said, thank you, Mac, for inviting me. It's a very august group of speakers. When Mac called me, he asked if I could speak on how DoD could be a better customer. But then he also asked if I'd put a couple sentences in on my bio. So what I'm going to do is take those couple sentences to answer the first question. So yes, and as a good trained military officer, I'm going to give the bottom line up front, three main points. I'm going to repeat what I said and get off the stage. So looking at my background and where I came from, how I could contribute to this body, in two words, sustainment matters. And I'm talking about sustainment of weapon systems, logistics, sustainment matters. It's fully one-third of the defense budget. It's fully 70% of any weapon system over its life cycle. Sustainment matters. My background. So I was a maintenance officer. The planes I worked on were older than me. The planes I flew were older than me. And when I decided to get out of the military after the 90s and the downturn and the hollow force that we talked about, I thought it would be pretty straightforward to come to Washington to help lend voice to this idea of a spending death spiral. If people around here are familiar with Chuck Spinning and his work, this idea that the systems were getting older and older, they were costing more and more, exponential cost growth in weapon systems was squeezing out procurement. So I thought, get a job at the Congressional Budget Office, go collect that data that must have been collected, and this is going to be a no-brainer. Not so much. Go to the Navy, they'd been collecting 2-3 years of data. They had a new system called VAMOSC. I'm sure it doesn't exist anymore. The Air Force total operating costs, these were becoming buzzwords. They were collecting data. They didn't have more than 6 years because they had changed how they actually account for flying hours and costs. But I spent about a year working and doing some original regression analysis to determine where this cost growth was, where this death spiral was. I thought it'd be real easy to show we should buy new, it'll be cheaper. Turns out cost growth is not exponential. Cost growth is linear, 1% to 3% growth per year, and that's for an F-22 or a KC-135. At the time, they were talking about, the Air Force was talking about exponential cost growth in the KC-135 because of some very unique system problems. Once they fixed those unique system problems, the cost increase went right back to normal. The point there was the death spiral conversations kind of ended. Also, the war kicked off, so that kind of ended the idea of we needed to collect data. So the first point is the data matters, and actually understanding what data you're collecting and what you're analyzing it for matters, and you can make a difference. Leaving the Congressional Budget Office, I got a job on the Senate Armed Services Committee as their budget person, and I wish John Etherton was here because I was going to congratulate him for actually finally saying budget matters. He and I have debated that at times. I do think it does, but John brought all that up. I won't repeat. I do think you need to be realistic. I could sit up here and talk about depots and how public depots, all 17 of them, are wastes of money and we could do this better in the private sector, but the reality is, given the political environment, we're not going to get rid of all 17 depots next year or in the next 5 years. One of the parts of the portfolio that I did have that I want to bring up in this conversation is I also had oversight of, for the Republican side, for financial management. And I talked to my counterpart, and this had been a high-risk area for the Government Accountability Office since they started creating high-risk areas. Financial management in the Pentagon, ripe for fraud, waste, and abuse. So I talked to my counterpart, who I'll mention who it is later. Then we reached out to the Department of Defense, to the senior assistant secretaries and the deputy assistant secretaries, and then to the, back to the Government Accountability Office and said, let's get together and talk about what a system of oversight would look like. Every 6 months, every year, we had our senators' support. What would it look like to actually make progress? And we mapped out a plan of doing hearings every 6 months, sticking with it, and over several years, we actually got off the high-risk list. Now, where financial management of the Pentagon is, you can ask Peter Levine, because he was my counterpart that I worked with on this, and he's now the Deputy Chief Management Officer. The third, third personal anecdote about how this all works, and the points I want to leave you with. After I left the Senate Armed Services Committee, I got hired by Dr. John Hamry at the Center for Strategic International Studies. I see Andrew's here. And while I was there, we were approached by a couple of trade associations to take a look at when Secretary Gates was kept on under President Obama in his first term, he started making pronouncements about insourcing. Again, our British fellow talked about services. This is a very important part of this discussion. But Secretary Gates started talking about 40% savings in insourcing. He reformed that to maybe 25% savings. For every job that you insource, we're going to save 25%. What's interesting about that was a little more than a decade prior when Dr. Hamry was at the Pentagon, outsourcing saved 15 to 30%. Every job outsourced was going to save 15 to 30%. We do two more turns of that and everyone must work for free. So we started to look. We went to the Pentagon, you know, knocking on doors, doing the interviews, cost analysis and program evaluation. They have just stood up a sustainment office because they finally realized that that's important, 2012. So some people are coming late to the game that sustainment is important. The data wasn't there. We thought, well, maybe they've figured out the overhead problem. Again, another thing Etherton mentioned, how to analyze it, how to compare public sector versus private sector. The data wasn't there, and neither was the policy. After we started even just asking the questions, the Secretary of the Army first walked away from the strategy of insourcing. They took the money, but they stopped the insourcing. I bring up that anecdote to talk about if you're going to have a policy, it needs to be transparent, it needs to be verifiable, it needs to be repeatable, and somebody needs to be held accountable. And if you think that issue went away just a month ago, the Air Force started touting again to us on a separate topic about 30% savings on a per in-source job on another project. Did they figure out how overhead gets captured? Did they figure out the private sector labor rates? I'm not sure. I doubt it. Did they go back to a speech that Secretary Gates made in 2009? Which somebody must have told him that it saves. The issue there, again, is analysis that can be backed up and supported. So I gave you my my bottom line up front that sustainment mattered. It matters in the data, in potentially doing the joint oversight and partnering in oversight, in being transparent and accountable. Things like performance-based logistics, and I'll wrap up on just two little points of how this translates. Performance-based logistics, we put a man on the moon, but we can't figure out how to compete inside a performance-based logistics contract. I doubt that. We just haven't really worked at that. They shouldn't be diametrically opposed to each other. Commercial practices and I'm getting off topic, but the commercial practices, we know how to buy things. We should know how to sustain them. And I'll leave with that. Thanks.
I heard Andrew Hunter's here. Andrew Hunter, our next speaker, is director of the Defense Industrial Initiatives Group at CSIS. He worked for 4 or 5 years in the Obama administration at AT&L, both for Secretary Carter and Secretary Frank Kendall. Former professional staff member of the House Armed Services Committee and MLA for both former Congressman Dix and former Congressman Spratt. Great to see you. Thank you for coming.
Well, thanks, Mac. You know, when you put it the way that you just did, which is a great introduction, it occurs to me that at some point in time in my career, I've been the enemy of just about everyone in this room. So But the nice thing about being at a think tank is you can be everybody's friend. So it's a nice place to be and a good place to be. It's a very distinguished group, so I'm honored to be here today. Obviously, our topic today, Defense Acquisition Forum, is a very broad one, and I appreciate that because, as I like to tell folks, being in Defense Acquisition Reform is a continuous employment insurance program because it's always popular. It's always a hot topic of debate. And I actually think it probably should be because it is something that continually needs improvement and is improved or can be improved on a continuous basis. So today I want to kind of focus on where we are now. It's noteworthy that the defense authorization bill, with probably the most significant and extensive changes to acquisition statute, actually I missed whether it had been signed today or late yesterday or later today or exactly where things stood, but in any sense it's effectively at this point enacted. It's going to become law. And we have a budget deal which dealt at least to some extent with the budget uncertainty, which has been a huge handicap for the acquisition system. It's only a temporary deal, it's too short, but it's the best possible outcome, I think, that was obtainable. So it's good news really on two fronts there. One thing I think it's important to note, though, about the bill, I said it's very substantive, it's very extensive, and that's true. But it's also a suite of legislative provisions that really won't reveal their true shape until they're fully implemented. And that may be a process of several years because, and I think appropriately so for legislation, not all the details are spelled out. Quite a bit is left to the discretion and one would hope the expertise of the executive branch to shape and implement these provisions and what they're really going to mean to the industrial base, what they're really going to mean to the workforce and how the system operates is very much yet to be told. And that's true across the board, from the way that the change in the role of the service chiefs is implemented, to a lesser extent the MDA change, although I think that's somewhat straightforward, and certainly the way that the department implements the changes to commercial item provisions and intellectual property, what's really going to happen as a result of this legislation is still very much up in the air. And so I want to talk a little bit about where I hope those things will go in implementation. I always like to start with what's the goal, what's the objective. For me, the way I like to summarize it is the objective is an acquisition system that's responsive to warfighter needs. And that responsiveness can take on different characteristics at different times depending on what the warfighter needs. It can be faster. It can be higher end. It can be cheaper. It's kind of what is the imperative of the day. By the way, it's worth noting you generally can't get all three of those at the same time. That's a longer testimony that I gave to the HASC on that topic a couple of weeks ago that you can check out. I mentioned some of the things that I think will be important in trying to get us to that goal. I think the role of the service chiefs that was enhanced in this authorization bill, I'm hoping that it'll be implemented in a way where the service chiefs get actively engaged to ensure that there is continuous dialogue between the acquisition community and the requirements community throughout the acquisition process. Not that we want churn or change, but just the constant back and forth about what do these requirements really mean, what's really available in the technological base that it can inform the requirements process as it goes forward. And that's something that I think we did fairly well, actually, in rapid acquisition over the last several years, that back and forth between the two communities along with the budget community, and it served us very well. One of the other big items that I hope to see implemented in a way that encourages more responsive acquisition is this middle path or middle tier of acquisition that the Senate bill proposed and is carried through into the final version. And there, I think, when we are trying to find a more responsive acquisition system, I also want to think of it in terms of more adaptable systems. As we've had this dialogue, it was a prominent feature of the Reagan Defense Forum that happened last weekend about how do you deal with the pace of technology change, the need for the third offset strategy. It seems to me that we have to have systems that are more adaptable since we're not going to buy a whole new set of weapon systems every 5 years. To get new technology into the system, you're going to have to implement it on existing systems. And those systems have to have the inherent flexibility. And to my mind, the poster child for that has really been the Predator system, which adapted tremendously over the course of the last 10 years as we kept identifying new needs in the warfight. And so new weapons, new sensors were continuously added to that system. I think it's a really great example of what can be done and what's good about our system. Interestingly enough, it also highlights what it is about our system that makes that really hard, because the Predator program was always kind of on the verge of a Nunn-McCurdy breach, not because they had necessarily done anything wrong or experienced tremendous cost growth, but just that the baselines that had been established early on didn't contemplate all this new material that the system was going to need to incorporate. And they didn't because they really can't. If you're truly dealing with an adaptable weapon system, you're not going to know 30 years ahead of time everything that you're going to want to do to that thing. It's not possible. And so this whole push in our system towards, you know, chalk marking a baseline and everything gets evaluated to that, and boom, once you hit 15%, you're in trouble. Once you hit 25%, we want you to terminate and go away. That system doesn't fundamentally work with a system that's trying to create adaptable weapon systems over time. Now, you can't take it to the other extreme to where there is absolutely no sense of discipline or restraint, but I think we need to find a way to capture at least those systems that are designed and meant to be highly adaptable towards a different approach. Another key enabler of that is funding flexibility, and I know that's been mentioned by some of the previous speakers and by John, and I always agree with John. I didn't hear his remarks, but I'm sure I can associate myself with him because he always speaks brilliantly. And I know he and I have similar thoughts on this issue of the importance of funding and being able to react in real time and not have to wait 2 to 3 years to wait for an appropriation every time an opportunity comes along or an urgent need comes along. As I mentioned, the commercial item provisions in the legislation that's just passed, there is also an important concept that the bill introduces or reintroduces about non-developmental items. Because in my mind, there's nothing holy or sacred about commercial. I don't mean to offend Jack. I see he's here. But the commercial in itself, it's a good thing, but it's not necessarily the end game is not just to be commercial or to support commercial. It's about leveraging the best that's out there, affordability, and about being able to take access technologies that were developed on somebody else's dime, which is always a nice thing if you can do it. And so the bill takes a step towards recognizing it's really the non-developmental aspect and the affordability aspect that's important, not so much whether it's something is sold more than 50% of the time to a commercial customer. And so I think that's something we're going to have to think through and think about how we define that in a way that our contracting officers can embrace and understand in the years coming. And I'm probably getting close to the end of my time. Along those lines, obviously the move towards open systems approaches is highly in accord with what I've been trying to say about wanting to acquire adaptable systems. That's an important initiative. It's always fascinating to me the service differences. I've been talking to both the Air Force and the Navy about how they approach open systems. They approach it exactly opposite, which is perhaps the most valuable thing in the world. Air Force has more of a top-down approach, Navy more of a inside-out approach. And I even cross metaphors when I tried to compare the two because they're so different. Interestingly enough, they assert, or at least I should say the Air Force asserted, that the two approaches really get you to the same place and they are compatible. So hopefully, knock on wood, that's true. Because at the end of the day, if the Air Force open mission system standards fundamentally are misaligned with the Navy's open standards, that's going to be a real problem for industry. And we don't have Q&A, so I can't put anyone from industry on the spot as to how you see it. But that's an issue that we really need to explore going forward. We want to embrace open systems. I think it's a key to where we need to go, but it also needs to be something that industry is totally bought into and not being whipsawed between various services and various parts of the Department of Defense. Obviously, that ties back into also intellectual property, which is a key issue, both in terms of traditional industry and very much for non-traditional industry that is sometimes captured with the phrase Silicon Valley, although I think it's much broader than that. It's really all over the country, essentially just referring to companies that don't primarily or haven't primarily worked with DoD in the past. And then the last thing I kind of want to touch on, although I can't really dig too deep into it in given time, but it's this idea that actually our friend and colleague from Great Britain brought up about essentially acquisition through services. And this is something that has been controversial in our system. It's been controversial in the United States, and you can wander off into the L-word territory about leasing, and it gets can get very messy. But there is a lot of potential there. And you know, one of the more remarkable things that has happened in acquisition over the last 15 years is that we've had a new entrant, a major new entrant in the most unlikely of spaces, which is space launch. And you know, I don't take sides and you know who's the better competitor in that competition, but the fact that there is a competition is fairly remarkable and something sort of new and different under the sun, which you don't get a lot, particularly in Washington. But it's really, in a lot of ways, is enabled by acquisition through services approach. Space launch as a service rather than and NASA really committing to that approach really made that new entrant possible. It gave it a foothold that was that could be gotten hold of and has gotten to us to a place where I think this week proposals are due for the first national security launch that's been competed in a very long time, which is, again, something new under the sun. So there's a lot of positive, encouraging trends in defense acquisition reform right now. I actually would take a little bit of an issue with some of, if you will, the rhetoric that's out there about how the system is getting progressively worse. It's not true. I think if you really dig down into the numbers, the last several years, cost growth has not been occurring. I don't know. I don't think our performance maybe is quite as good as what you've been enjoying in Great Britain in the last 10 years, but there has been improvement. It is not a continuously upward explosion, as Greg was saying. When you look at the numbers, it's not a continuously upward explosion of cost growth. We are making progress, and there's some really encouraging, we use the word green shoots, happening, and we need to stick with it. We need to keep the dialogue going and keep working together on it. And I would just close by saying I think what is also most encouraging and grounds for optimism is that there's a priority on defense acquisition reform in Congress, a priority in the administration, a priority, if you will, in the broader defense community and in the press. And so I think keeping the effort going and keeping everyone talking to one another and working together is where we need to be. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Christine Fox, the Assistant Director for Policy and Analysis at Johns Hopkins University's Applied Physics Lab. She is the former Acting Deputy Secretary of Defense in 2013 and 2014, and she was also the Director of CAPE at the Office of Secretary of Defense, so has tremendous and excellent experience in this area, and we're looking forward to your remarks.
Well, thank you very much. I think everybody in this room knows how important this topic is at this time in our history, so I really appreciate the opportunity to be a part of the Lexington Institute series on this topic. As is clear from the talks today, everyone in this room also knows how many times we have tackled the topic of defense acquisition reform, and of course we will continue to do so. I think while we have conceived, designed, fielded amazing capabilities, I think it's pretty clear that we also need to evolve. Now, as others have suggested today, I'm in the camp that suggests everything doesn't need to evolve. Ships and planes and large armored vehicles, they need to be developed carefully, they need to be tested, and they need to be procured with rigorous processes. We need to ensure that they work, and yes, sustainment matters. I couldn't agree more. And while it's not very popular to say it these days, I personally think that oversight is indeed necessary for those processes. Now, I'm not saying it can't be improved. I hope everybody wrote down Ken Miller's list because, boy, I thought it was spot on. Those are exactly the categories of the things that we ought to keep hard working on to try to make them better, to make them support that process more efficiently and effectively for what we need to do. But we can't throw that process out. At the same time, it's pretty clear we need new ways to respond to the pressure on our technological edge that I think we're all feeling. The world has changed. Technology has changed. Times have changed. And we need to be thinking about that in addition to the way that we think about evolving and improving our acquisition process for those major weapon systems. In today's DoD budget and throughout the entire downturn, there's an attempt to protect to the degree possible the S&T and R&D investments. But the truth is in this budget environment, we won't be fielding new programs that aren't currently designed or in the process anytime soon. And we also face many new threats from our potential adversaries and across a very broad spectrum of capabilities. So I think the question is, how do we develop capabilities across that broad spectrum with no money and no time? And that really requires us to think about at least part of the acquisition process, I submit to you, very differently. I think we need new concepts for those technologies that maybe don't need to last for 30 years, or that don't need the kind of complex development associated with planes and ships and armored vehicles. At APL, we're working on some concepts like this. I'm going to throw them out today. They are ideas, not plans. They aren't the solutions. They are a solution. But I think that I want to offer them to you as the kind of thinking that I hope we can be doing together as a community as we think about challenges in this sort of new world. So the first one we're working on is a concept we're calling tech on the shelf. So now to understand this concept, I need to ask you guys to think about a movie. I want you to think about Batman. And don't tell me you haven't seen it. I know many of you have. So I want you to think about the scene where Bruce Wayne goes down in Wayne Enterprises to meet Lucius Fox and look around at the basement in Wayne Enterprises, right? And Lucius is showing him around to all of the military prototypes that they developed at Wayne Enterprises that the military, in the end, didn't pick up and field. Bruce Wayne looks around, and what does he see? He sees an entirely new set of applications for those very technologies. And he goes around and picks out the ones that he wants and asks that they be painted black. Okay? What if we, in the national security world, in DOD, had a basement? What if in that basement we had prototypes, not things on a shelf that were gathering dust, but that were living, breathing prototypes? Prototypes that we pulled off the shelf, that we maintained, that we upgraded, and I think critically importantly, that we deployed and tested through experiments and exercises with the operating forces, such that the operating forces could evolve their CONOPs as our technology developed. And what if those technologies could continue to advance over time, even though they would not be procured in large numbers, at least not right away? Now, at some point, hopefully, because we start making sensible decisions about what our national security needs really are, and not in response to some terrible crisis, the defense budget will be set to a level we can once again afford to start fielding new capabilities. Now envision that future world where we have our basement, and now we go to that basement and we know exactly which prototypes to pull out and start fielding because we've tested them. We know that they're updated. We know that the operators are waiting for them, and the operators have told us which ones of those things in our basement are the most important because we've been experimenting with them, and we start producing them. If we could do that, we would save back the time that we're losing today by not being able to do it because we have so many constraints on our budget and our system. Okay, so that's one idea. Now, what if we were to couple that idea with advances in additive manufacturing, which everybody here is also very aware of, right? That's another area in technology that's going at this incredible rate. So now you marry our prototypes in the basement with this idea that they could, in the future, be produced on demand. I think that would be a paradigm shift, right? Now we could save a lot of money for having to have a stockpile of things, and we could provide them when and where they were needed, efficiently and effectively, production on demand. Okay, as I said, are these the solutions? No, of course not. These are ideas. But my point of offering them to you today is to suggest that as we think about defense acquisition reform, we understand as Ken so well said, there's only so many levers there. We know what they are. We know how to work on them. And frankly, we produce pretty awesome stuff through it. And we need to continue to produce those things. And we need to continue to make that system efficient. But inching away on defense acquisition reform, I'm not sure it's going to propel us into this new world where we need new game-changing capabilities, maybe that don't last for 30 years, but that give our operators that technological edge that's applicable in today's world. So again, I thank you very much for the opportunity to participate in this important topic. So thank you.
I heard that Dr. LaPlante is in the room. Is he here? Oh, very good. Thank you. Nice to see you, sir. Thank you for coming. Our next speaker is Dr. William LaPlante. If you're ready.
I'm always ready.
I've figured you might be. Assistant Secretary of the Air Force for Acquisition. Dr. LaPlante has more than 29 years' experience in defense technology, including positions at the MITRE Corporation, as well as Johns Hopkins University. And he has been a member of the Defense Science Board as well. Sir, thank you so much for coming up.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Being a little surprised. I was told I was the 16th of 16 speakers. And I thought, man, it takes you 5 minutes just to get through introductions, most of the places I've worked. Certainly my introduction takes a long time. Anyway, hi, everybody. I'm not going to talk about acquisition reform unless you ask me to, because it's been talked about to death. I want to talk to you about what's going on overseas. I just got back from the Dubai Air Show. Very interesting. I'm trying to think. There were a couple of reporters that were with me on the plane coming back. I don't see them here. They're still sleeping. Aaron Mehta and Laura, they're probably still, they can't hold up with this. So let me tell you what's going on. First thing that's going on is the U.S. stuff is in incredible high demand overseas. I mean, people are desperate. They're desperate for our stuff. It's taking way too long to get it to them. We tell them, the good news is, it used to be a very short conversation. It was, oh, you want that? No. We used to have very efficient, short conversations. Now we have very inefficient, long conversations. Like, we'll try, and it's a very laborious process that goes across multiple agencies. We need to do something about it, okay? And it's urgent. It's urgent for the following reasons. Number one is, I said, you know, in Washington, our acquisition program is broken. We can't do anything right. Everything's bad, blah, blah, blah. Overseas, it's like, you guys have the best stuff. You guys, we buy it from you. It works. You know how you help us sustain it? You train us? There's nobody else like you. I go, well, you tell Washington that? Because they don't believe that. Well, I'll tell you what, it's unbelievable. Now, on the other hand, here's the urgency. The urgency is right now, they're fighting wars. The Saudis and the United Arab Emirates, their number one issue right now is fighting the Houthis in Yemen. They're having issues of munitions, having issues of ISR. On the good news side, the UAE says we wouldn't be able to do what we're doing if it wasn't being associated with the United States Air Force for the last several decades. By the way, they're doing the whole job themselves. I mean, we're helping them a little bit with ISR and tanker support. They have their own tankers. Most of the tankers are their own. Most of the ISR is their own. Doing their own UAV flying, their own munitions that have been trained. Their pilots have all been trained by us. They're doing an incredible job. Okay. But here's the thing, they need more. And guess who's over there selling stuff? Oh, I don't know, a place called China? Guess how many UAVs China's selling over there? You think China has an interagency process like ours to buy a UAV? How about an armed UAV? You think China has an issue of policy on armed UAVs? Probably not. Are they as good as ours? No. It's kind of like, you know, we got the Apple store. Apple wins its customers with not just its products, but with its customer service. If you're, you know, my daughter's going to be an Apple person for life because of how they've treated her. Okay? Right next to the Apple store, which has the long line outside it, is another store has opened up and is selling Apple products, but they're not really Apple products, but they certainly look like it. I got on my phone, I should show you the pictures I took of some displays at Dubai of, I thought was an MQ-9. It's not an MQ-9, it just looks like one. J-31. You guys know the J-31? I walked up to the model of it. Other than the two engines, it's F-35. Now, is it really F-35? Is it really Predator? Probably not, of course. But they're doing the same thing with UAVs. Now, how much of this is bluster and how much is not, I don't know. But our partners are saying, well, you know what? If, at least if I buy that stuff, even if it doesn't work, if it works a third of the time compared to your stuff, at least I have something. Now, how much of that is bluster, I don't know. Our industry partners saying the same thing. They're saying, we had one group, I met yesterday, whatever time zone I'm in now, with a bunch of mid-level suppliers at Dubai. One of them told me they're having to send jobs overseas to get around ITAR and some other export issues. They're actually having to manufacture and do things overseas. This is a problem, guys. We need to fix this. And it's urgent because we have to ask ourselves, what do we want the Middle East to look like 10 years from now in terms of military capability? What do we want? What capability do we want all our allies and partners to have that we're going to have to fight with? Do we want them to use Link 16? Yes. Do we want them to use things more advanced than Link 16? Yes. Do we want them to be flying Predators or MQ-9s or variants of that as opposed to China? Yes. That's the issue, and I think it's as urgent an issue as anything else. You want to put that under acquisition reform umbrella, you're welcome to do it. But I think it's imperative. And I was really struck by it. And again, because those guys are at war. It's existential for them. This is existential for them. And we've talked in bilats with many of the countries over there, including Jordan, obviously Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, all the way around. And we heard the same thing from everybody. Some of them were more polite than others. Some of them were a little more direct. Then we sat down with industry. Industry said the same thing. I said, well, I'm going back to Washington to talk on one of these acquisition reform things. I'll talk about this. So this is something we need help. We need help in educating the Congress. We need to help educating the media. We have to educate ourselves. Now, let me make no mistake. There's a reason that it's hard for us to sell our products overseas, that we make it hard. Because we are concerned about keeping our best technology for us. That's understandable. And it's kind of a, once you make the decision once to let a technology out, you can't undo that decision. I got that. But here's the thing. We better be consistent, and we better be transparent. Because it's also the uncertainty that's killing us. If you're entering a process to try to get approval of something that you may not get approval for a year and a half, and you're sitting there saying, okay, and I'm in line at the Apple store, and I look at the line, I look next to me, there's no line there, and it's half price. I know this stuff sucks, but maybe I can go over there, maybe I'll get lucky. That's the situation we're in right now, so we need your help. That was what I wanted to say. I will only say this on acquisition reform. I said I wouldn't at the beginning, and I don't know, are you taking questions? Are people taking questions? No, okay, good.
We could take one or two questions.
Whatever you want to do. Acquisition reform, all good. All good, you know, House bill's good, Senate bill's good, NDA's good. Let's do more. You know, it's not rocket science. We know what we need to do. People in this room know what you need to do. Do acquisition right, hold requirements firm, you know, set the program up right, have a robust industrial base, have a strong government team, incentivize industry for the right things. Don't change things left and right. Don't go chasing like a squirrel every new technology or every new fad that comes along. Rules don't change. That's what it needs. We know how to be successful. We are being successful, despite what you read. I'm actually a data guy. You know, is it what they say, the plural of anecdote is not data. And data says in the Air Force that our prices, our costs, every year continue as a net to come down. I'm sorry that that's what the data says, but it says that. Do we have programs going up in cost? Yes, we do. OCX is going up in cost. Courtney will write about that again. This is a ground control station for GPS. On net effect, the prices, the costs are coming down. Okay? Our programs, KPPs, are, you know, for our ACAT-1s, that's the basically requirements, are 95%. Where we need to do work, we need to deliver things faster because we're still, our development timelines are too long. That's the truth, guys. There's not much more to it than that. So if you want to help us with acquisition, help us while focus on the right things. Focus on speed. We need to do things faster, but we can't do speed at the expense of competition. That's one thing you have to remember. Sometimes the easy button is to go sole source. You can do something really fast going sole source. But, you know, necessarily you want to keep competition. So you have to weigh that. We also have to, we want to do commercial. Commercial's great. But remember, if we're buying a commercial, so can anybody else. So at some point, you don't buy everything commercial because you don't want our stuff to be available commercial. The stuff that makes sense to buy commercial, buy commercial. What's the problem then? The problem is we can't decide, and we have to decide as a society, as a country, what's more important to us, finding the next $700 hammer, which is always, there's always this, the pursuit of it, as there should be, versus making buying commercial actually practical. And we all in our lives have accidentally paid too much for something, maybe not accidentally, purposefully. I tell the story that about a month ago, I have a 2011 Pilot. I took it into the dealer in like the 2 hours I have to do everything for my life, which is Saturday morning from like 9 to 11. I got to get my hair cut, do all that stuff in that 2 hour block. And dealer did it, and he said, but you know, your battery's on its last legs. I go, I know, but it's fine. Just leave it alone. I got to go. Driving home from work, pull over to get something, do some shopping, get back in the car, doesn't start. It's first cold evening, I'm like, crap, the dealer was right. I get it jumped, I get it home, and I go, how can I get the battery fixed? I've got to go on a trip tomorrow morning at whatever, 6, I got to be doing this, I got this. You know, I got a busy job. And so I thought, well, AAA. Now, AAA will come and bring a battery. So I told my wife, I said, okay, if I just have them do it. She goes, okay. So I called them up, and they came by. The guy talked to him about the Redskins, and he, you know, was a good guy. He put my battery in. I don't remember how much it was. I think it was 150. Way too much, right? I couldn't do that, but I didn't care because I got the thing done. I couldn't do that in my job. In this job, I'd have an IG chasing me. We have to decide when we're talking about commercial, you know, what are we willing to accept as a society? I'll say one other thing, and then I'll stop. I'm a big fan, as a geek, of what people like Elon Musk are doing. I'm not talking about, you know, he's one of our potential suppliers, but I'm just talking about what he's doing with his different companies, right? Most geeks like kind of follow what people like Elon Musk are doing. So I always ask this question to people. I said, what's he trying to do in landing that first stage on a barge? What's he trying to do? He's trying to close the business case to go to Mars to join Matt Damon. So, okay, that's good. I know people who are really smart, much smarter than me in space, that don't believe it's going to work. Either it won't work technically or the business case won't close. But he's doing it anyway. How many times has he tried to land this thing on the barge? How many, Byron? 4. I think it's 4, Byron. You guys, you know, and he puts a tweet out right afterwards, and if it doesn't work, which it hasn't, he's 0 for 4. He says rockets are tricky things. No, close but no cigar, that kind of thing. But everybody loves it. Do I think he's going to pull it off? I do. I absolutely do. I think everybody else is following. He says, now imagine for a second if that was the United States government. Let's take the part of the Department of Defense that is supposed to be the most far outreaching, way ahead, take risk part, DARPA. If it was DARPA, they would have tried it twice and quietly said, we're stopping it. Just like hypersonic glide vehicle, same thing. And it would not be considered a success. It would have been considered a failure. If we had done it in the Air Force, if we had done it once, it would be an IG investigation. I'd be asked who we held accountable for it. And the headline would be talking about how this business case is a crazy idea. Now, am I saying that we should be doing things like that in the government? No, I think there are things that probably the government is even too risky for us to do. What I am saying is our attitude towards what we do we have to check it. Just like we have to check the attitude about the car battery. You know, we say we want commercial, we say we want risk-taking, we don't behave that way. And some of the same people and same institutions that say that on Monday, on Tuesday, are blasting because some commercial price went up. You know, so that's a thought I'd like to leave you with, is that, yeah, acquisition reform's great, commercial's great, you know. Let's do it. Let's do other transactional authority stuff. We're trying all that stuff. That's great. But let's also remind ourselves what's important. Colin, I'll stop.
Quick one, though.
And that was not prepared. That was completely off the I made it up on the plane.
You need to
and don't call me a
sell things man. More quickly.
Yeah.
How are you going to change the system given the congressional requirements, given the enormous number of regulations that have grown up?
Are you talking within the context of FMS or just in general?
Well, I assume you're talking largely about FMS.
When I came in here, my first half of my talk was on FMS, right? So you're asking about that. This is not going to be a good answer to this question. somebody asked this at the secretary when she had a press conference at Dubai. Reporter asked, would you need somebody even at the White House to coordinate this? That's, you know, we're talking about a whole of government issue here. We got the State Department involved, we got Commerce, we've got multiple parts of the Department of Defense, for all for reasons you can understand when it's explained to you. But the net effect of all of it is very frustrating. Now, we can decide as a country that it's okay, and I'm not kidding when I say this, we'll let the market play out, and if the Chinese, I don't pick on the Chinese because I'm trying to scare everybody, it's just the one that they're all talking about over there, but pick another country, that it's okay if their stuff is what gets sold, that's fine. But I don't think that's right. I don't think it's right for our industrial base. I don't think it's right for how we don't fight wars by ourselves, guys. We fight them joint, and we fight them with coalitions. And so that's to me. I think this is an urgent issue we need to solve. Yes. One more question.
One more fast one, and it also has to be friendly.
No, it doesn't have to be friendly. No, I like the unfriendly ones. Those are the funner ones.
Anybody?
Yeah. Hey, Byron. Yeah.
We've done that in the past, so what's changed? Do you have any insights?
I don't know that anything's changed, but I don't know what happened with Israel, say, in the 67 war. My guess is it probably went almost to the president. Here's the thing. Can we do this without involvement of the president? It's kind of like what Secretary Gates used to say, where he had to be the program manager of NRAPs. We can do NRAPs, but why do we have to have Secretary of Defense be the program manager? So I think we can do this, but can we do it without going to the leadership of the countries, because that's where this stuff is going to go. That's where it's going to go. Yeah.
Thank
okay,
so
thanks.
Much. Thank you very much. Appreciate you coming.
Thank you.
Mackenzie, are you ready to come up here? Mackenzie Eaglen is our next speaker, resident fellow at the American Enterprise Institute. She's a former research fellow for national security studies at the Heritage Foundation and the principal defense advisor to Senator Susan Collins of Maine. Thank you so much for coming. Great to see you.
So we're getting close to batting up time, so it's probably just about the right opportunity to actually pick up kind of where Andrew left off and Christine Fox and Dr. LaPlante continued. So when I survey Capitol Hill, which is where we are today, and their efforts this year, I know we've spoken a lot about the time in memoriam efforts at defense acquisition reform, but this year it did seem to be quite exhaustive in number and scope. So between the House and Senate defense policy bills, before there was a final conference version, there were over 150 acquisition reform provisions alone. That's pretty substantial. And what was the focus of the bill this year? Well, it's no surprise to everybody here, but it was focused on providing lots of new authorities in personnel and, of course, and in purchasing. Some of these won't even take effect for perhaps a year or so. And so what I'm here to offer is a sneak peek, a preview of where we can expect our friends on the authorization committees to go next year. Senator McCain and Congressman Thornberry, chairman of both committees, have said this was their opening round, but that next year they're going to double down on defense acquisition reform. And so, of course, my next question is, well, what else is there to do, not being Andrew Hunter, the expert in this? And so the focus next year will be on implementation and oversight, and those are the key areas of focus. So in some regards, the Congress is admitting something rare, which they typically do not do, which is that the things that are going to take effect over the next 12 to 24 months will need to be periodically revisited, updated, tweaked, and possibly changed as they take effect. Now, one of the biggest ones that we all know, of course, is the additional authorities provided back to the service chiefs somewhat. Now, that provision doesn't really take effect for almost a year now. The major defense acquisition portfolio programs are basically grandfathered under the AT&L office for the next year, give or take. But it's still something the many other 149 other provisions are all going to be enacted and followed closely. So they want the Defense Department to start using other transactions, waiver authorities, new commercial procurements, etc. So there are 10 areas of acquisition reform that the two chairmen have said that they're going to focus on. They feel like they've achieved 5 in this year's defense authorization bill, and there will be 5 areas of which they focus on next year. I'll give you 3 as a freebie. you want the other two, you'll just have to call me or something. Okay. So, and what do they believe is not done yet? Okay. So, the biggest is the elephant in the room, and by that I mean literally and figuratively, which is defense services acquisition reform. The focus is overwhelmingly on weapon systems, but yet the Pentagon spends the majority of its purchasing dollars buying services, not goods, not hardware, not equipment, but services, IT, and some cases commodities. It's the overlooked area of largesse that has very little attention on Capitol Hill. It's just not sexy. It's very, very complicated. It's overseen by literally two armies of civilian workforces at the Defense Department, both civilian payroll employees at DOD and federal contracting civilians as well. Those two workforces outnumber the entire active duty military. This is an area in, I can't even find the word, in great need of scrutiny and review. The people who are purchasing labor. What is labor? People. It's that simple. People performing a service. So things like medical, healthcare, TRICARE, the provision of services therein, construction, not just military construction, but other types, operations and maintenance of infrastructure, existing facilities and buildings, and even to some extent, some research and development investments. So they will be looking to find what are the best practices in the commercial marketplace. It does not mean that everything is going to be applicable. That's not at all what they are saying. It's simply a review to say what could be applicable, what might work, and let's try it if it does. What are the allies doing? That's already come up here today, this afternoon. What are our allies doing that we're not, that could also be useful and perhaps relevant? For example, in the United Kingdom, there's the use of sole source non-competitive contracts. Is that a vehicle that DOD can use more of, for example? The second is one I've already mentioned as well. I would put it under the services umbrella, but in this case, they're counting it as number two. That's information technology acquisition and purchases. Who's responsible? Who has a hand in that pot? And how do we determine success in terms of the output of IT enterprises across the largest federal agency? And then there's another one, which is more of the front end of the acquisition review, number three. And this is an area, again, sort of making sure the Defense Department is using as a customer, as a beneficiary of Congress's love and adoration in this regard, some of the things that were given to it, or possibly new processes and procedures. Again, a few have already come up here today. More operational prototyping, more risk reduction programs. What do these look like? What actually has to change to make it more successful? Does the definition of a defense program itself need to change in this regard? What about Nunn-McCurdy changes and tweaking that law? Not everything, of course, needs to be set in stone forever. There are times when we need to sunset even the best intentions. And that leads me to get off my top three of the five to the final sort of point and indicators of where Congress is going to go next year. So the Senate Armed Services Committee has been undertaking this 30 years of Goldwater-Nichols reform hearing series. Once the bill was complete, essentially a month ago, they launched this review. The intention is to finish it by January, certainly before the president's budget comes over the first Monday of February, but probably before even the new session of Congress begins next year. This is an organizational review, but it's also a process review, and it's certainly an acquisition review, including personnel. It's trying to cover everything, and it's also trying to look at 30 years later. By most metrics, Goldwater-Nichols has been a success, but there have been unintended consequences, and there are certainly things that need to be rolled back today. And these hearings started with, of course, Defense Secretary Gates. There are a couple of themes identified by the ranking member, Senator Jack Reed, and the chairman, Senator McCain, of what are they trying to get after as part of this effort. There are six enduring principles, two of which apply to this topic and forum today. One is providing for a more efficient defense management, and another is enhancing innovation and accountability in defense acquisition. And so where are they going, for example? So we have some insights from Secretary Gates in his hearing. The question, I think, will remain open even taking into account where the 2016 bill went, finding and striking that right balance between AT&L and the services, something that I know makes some people very happy in here. There were problems when the services had their own acquisition authority that led to greater centralization over that oversight, but then there are problems in the minds of the chairman and ranking member when the pendulum swung the other way. And so now the goal is to find a better balance between centralization and decentralization. So as I conclude, I will just summarize again. This year, new authorities, new processes, new procedures. Next year, it's going to be on implementation and oversight. And in about a year, Mac will invite us back, and I'll review how they did. All right. Thank you. Thanks.
Our next speaker is Greg Dahlberg, the former senior vice president for Washington operations for Lockheed Martin. He also was the Democratic staff director for the House Defense Appropriations Subcommittee with former Congressman Murtha, and also the Undersecretary of the Army in the Clinton administration. Thank you, Greg, for coming. Looking forward to your remarks.
All right, I know my role. I think I'm the last speaker, and I can't repeat anyone, and I have to be short. And so I'll just start by saying I will endorse the remarks of Phil Jasper and Byron Callan and a little bit of Dan, splash of Dan Goure in there. That's kind of where I'm at. And so, you know, we'll just leave it at that. And I'd like to maybe talk a little bit about something that hasn't been talked about yet. You're trying to find a topic here. It's very difficult with this esteemed room and a lot of really good ideas and a lot of excellent talent in this room. But I thought I'd talk a little bit about Congress and the reform efforts there. I'm an old appropriator. I was 20-some years in the committee. And you go back to, if you find the full committee office in the Capitol, you'll go look, and there's all the hearing records going back from the beginning of the committee, which is in the 1800s. The very first hearing that they had is about a lock and dam 21 or whatever it was that the Army Corps of Engineers was building in 18-something and another canal somewhere where there was a cost overrun. And they were just giving them hell about, the cost overruns. And we've got to reform this system. And I think all of you who are involved in acquisition reform, you have full careers ahead of you for sure, because it's a never-ending, not a battle. I think it's just a continuous process. And also the issues on cost growth and government spending are going to be with us forever. Doesn't mean we shouldn't work on it. A couple people in this room, I remember grilling in my time on appropriations, and we killed a couple programs, and we weren't happy with a few of them, and sometimes we rewarded them because they were doing good work. So, you know, this is not a new phenomenon. It's with us, and it will be with us forever. I think if you look at the congressional reform efforts, let's say the modern ones in the last 20 years or so, I kind of have a hard time finding real big successes. And I think there's nothing against the people at all who are all well-intended. I think what happens, a good example, I think, is the last, I won't name names, but a couple of the last bills started off pretty strong. But by the time the process ended with all of the discussion from many of the people in this room, for instance, and we saw all the differing viewpoints just today of, it's an incredibly complex subject. There are different views on this thing. And when Congress tries to pull all that together and get a rational process out of that, frankly, I don't think they do a very good job. And I, unfortunately, my own view is that much of the reform we've seen is half good, half bad, maybe more red tape than anything else, a little less, which is not good in my view. And it gets back to that time is money point, which would be my bottom line as well. I think that's really one thing that is not understood by this community, and it's not understood by the Congress, about how process and the delays that come from And I learned this in industry, having teams put together, having subcontractors put together, all engineering staffs all put together, waiting for, you know, a process to kind of come through through that huge decision cycle that happens because all these steps in that spaghetti chart, and I think we've all seen that spaghetti chart of the acquisition process, that is huge money. It's, and by the way, the contractor will recoup that money over time because, you know, they're not, it's not, nothing's free in this business. So, you know, to me, what I'd like to see is something pretty simple. I talked to my former staff about this, and they rolled their eyes. But I said, look, why don't you go to the Hill and say, instead of all these little tweaks to the system and getting more competition here and all the different processes that they were, you want to invent, how about just saying, Mr. Secretary, give us a plan a year from now to cut the time it takes for major acquisitions by a third. Just show us what you'll do with that. What would you cut out of the system? What kind of savings would you get from that? And leave it up to the experts to actually come up with a system that might, you know, really change things. And I think that's really what industry would actually like to see if you really got in the back rooms of the industry associations and so forth. That's the kind of change that would really wake up the system. And unfortunately, I don't, you know, I don't see that happen anytime soon. I will say that the spaghetti chart, as we call it, of the acquisition process will scare the dickens out of Silicon Valley and anybody else who wants to try to get into the into this game. I've had personal discussions in my time with industry folks from Fortune 5, Fortune 50 companies who have looked at coming into defense, and they said, man, we look at that process. There's no way we're jumping in there. Then they would come to us, as, at the time Lockheed Martin, and go, can we team with you? Can you show us how to get through this incredible process? Because they know they're going to fail, and they know it's going to be very expensive. So I think folks who kind of look at that as the golden cow of maybe the next generation for true innovation, I think they're going to be mistaken, because I don't think they're going to come. I think another thing that hasn't been talked about a little bit is the consistency of departmental strategy, acquisition strategy. That's a tough one. I get it. the problem is assistant secretaries change. They change quickly. And boy, can they change the nature of a program overnight in terms of what we were planning versus what they want. I'll give you one example. It's an old one now, presidential helicopter. I won't name names, but the assistant secretary back then who wrote the RFP, which was about five assistant secretaries earlier than when the decision to terminate happened, said, I want off the shelf. I don't want development. This is going to be cheap. It's going to be 85% solution. It's just the helicopter. You know, we'll protect it, what we need to protect, obviously. We'll get some comms in it, but this is going to be off the shelf. We're going to do it. That's how we bid it. That's how it was won. That's not how it ended up. A few little things, you know, and this is not meant to criticize, because I think these are just what happens. The White House comes in and says, well, we need to harden certain systems in there. We need 360-degree rotating seats so the president can have meetings inside. Well, just doing that added incredible weight to the system, because these seats are not cheap. They're custom-made. Carpet had to be thicker, all kinds of things like that, small things. But then things like, well, the White House photographer came up and said, you know, I don't like the rivets, you know, in next to the door. It wrecks the photo op. So we need to move that strut back out of the way so we have a clean you know, view of the camera. Well, I think all of you know, we move one strut in, and we did it, by the way, one strut into the guts of the helicopter. You're moving them all, and you're redesigning it. End of the day, we had to have add another rotor blade to the thing for the weight. We had to redesign the whole transmission. It was a new helicopter, and this was done for all good reasons, but that's very much why we had the cost growth in that system. Again, people at the beginning of the process who made the decision, set the parameters, weren't at the end. It's a fact of life of our system. I don't know how you change that. You can try to educate people, But, you know, everyone has a different, and I fear, for instance, the folks, many of the folks who came, who are now in place in the structure as decision makers, they're not going to be there when many of these systems, they're making decisions for future secretaries, many secretaries into the future. And I kind of guarantee you one thing, it's going to change as the thing goes forward. So it's a dynamic, tough, interesting process. You know, I think I congratulate everyone in this room for really, number one, sticking in there, but also really you really see the dynamics of how complex, how difficult this process is. And there's a lot of good thinking here, and there's also a lot of just good goodwill towards trying to do the right thing. I think I would include industry in that. Industry gets a bad rap sometimes, but definitely is trying to pull the weight of cost reduction and delivering more with less. So thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Greg. That concludes our program. I'd like to thank all the speakers for their outstanding presentations and doing a wonderful job keeping things on schedule. It was a very good forum. Constance Barutos of the Lexington staff organized another great event for us. Thank you, Constance, and thank you. Thank you for the good lunch. We will have a video of this forum posted on our website soon. The formal presentations we've received, we will circulate to you and also put them on our website. And we welcome any ideas you have for future events, future guest blogs, guest articles on our website and elsewhere. And thank you very much for participating, and have a great weekend. And good to see you, Jack Gansler. Thank you for coming. Thank you.